Good evening. It being on or after 7 o'clock, I'm going to open up the July 16th, 2015 meeting of the Georgetown Conservation Commission. This evening, we have some discussion items and a number of hearings. And I think since, Steve, we have everyone here, we could start off with our discussion items, I guess.
Yep, correct.
So the first item of discussion is an enforcement order on, 6 Heather Road. Do we have anyone representing the residents?
Good evening.
Good evening. Just want to introduce yourself for the record, please.
Yeah, I'm just going to set up my easel here.
No problem.
Probably going to end up being in a terrible spot. You know what? I'm going to set it up over here. Thanks.
My name is Bill Manuel, and my company is Wetlands and Land Management. And I'd like to continue the discussion about 6 Heather Road and the enforcement action. And one of the things that we've done since the last meeting was the owners have sent correspondence to the commission, a letter of apology, if you will, to try to set at least state their feelings. I don't know if you've all received that, but I want to make sure that you have. I'd like to pass out a copy of that and ask you to just take a moment to just read it. It's just a few paragraphs. Hopefully you would have received this already. Good, because the owners somewhat misinformed, obviously made a mistake. There is no contempt to this commission, and they want to set the record straight that they're willing to and want to do everything that they need to do and can do to get back into compliance and have a reasonable outcome to this whole matter. Having said that, they've also invited you to go out to the site and do a site walk as a commission. And I would highly encourage that because I don't really think you can appreciate the matter unless you've seen it and see where it's come from. I know there was some cutting, and you may have seen pictures from a few months ago, but the restoration, as the nature is sort of taken on its own, the restoration is progressing nicely on its own. I'm not saying that we are going to shortcut any of the restoration, but I think it's important as you consider this enforcement matter that you come out and visit the property.
Mm-hmm. I did read the letter, but just to set the record straight, I mean, while this was occurring, the homeowners were working with another wetland scientist who told them not to do some of these things, I understand, and they did them anyway. And how we got involved is via that wetland scientist. So I read this and certainly understand it, but, I think there was some intent here, too. So just to be clear on that.
Nevertheless, trying to move forward. I've been engaged since then. Did not have any dealings with the previous hearings. I don't know what went on, what was said. I am sitting in front of you now, and I'm trying to get the Giswaldes to a point where they're back into compliance, and the commission is satisfied with the outcome. And to that end, I think it's important that the commission come out and look at the pathway that was constructed, look at the float, and make your own judgments. See where it's come from in the couple of months since it's been done. And I think that's going to be beneficial to the whole proceeding here.
What was the time frame for removal of the stairs? Did we have a set time frame?
I thought it was 30 days?
No, you, in the original enforcement order, you gave a timeframe to submit a restoration plan, which was done in a timely fashion. At the last meeting, you asked for some revisions per the vote that you took to ratify the enforcement order. I have submitted those revisions, and so everything is in a timely fashion, and we're waiting for the commission to approve the restoration plan. You did specify a time date in there. I think it was 2 weeks hence after this meeting to get the restoration stuff done.
I think the whole thing was 30 days.
Yeah. I'd like to talk about that this evening as well, but I would like to ask, I don't see that there's any blazing hurry, because frankly, to try to put a restoration plan in place in the middle of the summer is counterintuitive. The plants do not do well when you put them in the heat of August. I would suggest to you, even if you said to us tonight, you have to go forward, I'd suggest to you that September 1 is a better time frame to try to enact any restoration, because the plants just do better after the heat of the summer, and there's a greater likelihood of survival. So I would have brought that up for discussion tonight anyway. But in the ensuing time, I think it is worthwhile for everyone here that we convene on the site and take a look at what's there.
Any commissioners want to?
I do have a question regarding the dock removal, float removal.
Yes.
Was there just one company that was asked to remove, or have they tried to other companies?
No, they went with the original installer. The float is still under warranty, and they did not want to have any other company touch it. Otherwise, the warranty is voided. So,
just explain to me again why we can't just pull this up on the shore.
Mm-hmm.
Is it?
It requires some disassembly. Again, there's a warranty factor to it. It requires disassembly, as I mentioned to you at the last meeting. Other people along the pond, they don't have any vegetation along the pond front. It's completely lawn straight down to the edge. What we have here is all vegetation, very thick vegetation, except for a very narrow area. And it's impractical to try to pull that size float up that narrow area.
And just from my memory again, what is the dimensions of the float again?
It's a,
it's approximately
12 by 20.
12 by 20, that's a pretty big one.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's in line with what else is out there all along the pond.
12 by 20?
Yep.
No, I disagree with you on that. Yeah,
but you'll see, hopefully when you go out there, that it is certainly in line with what's certainly surrounding and in sight of this particular float.
Just to refresh my memory regarding the steps, and I understand that's what they want to leave in, not remove them. And I think our concern was the fact, maybe I'm wrong, is that the sheet water would, it'd be like a flume, in the sense the water coming off the yard would shoot down that area and create erosion.
I have to tell you, that's just not the case. The lawn area within the permitted area of work for the house has been established, and there is no sheet flow concentrating at that point. So it's just not the case. And if you come out, you will see that. You will see, and actually I have some pictures of what it looks like with minimal care.
So the grade isn't going down towards the lake, is what you're saying, because you're saying there's no water coming off of the property, so it must be graded the other way?
No, what I'm saying is with the establishment of the lawn, it disperses the water. You don't have shallow concentrated flow collecting and shooting down there like a flume. You see from those pictures that are going around that some of the cut vegetation, namely the sweet pepper bush, it you know, when it is cut, it does regenerate by root sprouting, and you'll see that it's actually coming up right next to the stairs. And you can see actually that there's actually grass growing in through the cracks in the stairs. So it's certainly not an area where it's a flume directing water down to the lake.
Do
Do commissioners want to take a site visit? It's up to you all.
Yeah.
Can I ask a question?
Sure.
I mean, I thought the enforcement was intended to address the fact that the work was done in a clear, no-cut, no-disturb area, which was clearly marked with boundaries that said, in English, no-cut, no-disturb on them. And so the enforcement order is intended to address the work that was done in a place where it shouldn't have been done. I'm not really all that concerned with how it's regenerating or revegetating on its own right now. We really need to address the fact that the work was done in a way that it should never have been done, in a completely unpermitted and clearly not okay way.
I understand that.
In my mind, that's what the enforcement order is for, to address that misdoing.
I understand your concern, but the reason why I'd like the commission to go out there is because when you see the stairs and how the ground is in fact stabilized, professionally, I cannot sit here in front of you and recommend, let's tear it all out and then try to restabilize the bank. It makes no sense, and that's what I'd like you to see. Now, if there's, if you need to address the violation in another way, I understand that, but, and we certainly are willing, and a portion of the buffer zone restoration plan certainly will reestablish the area of the no-cut zone that's been cut over. But I just can't sit here and say with a straight face that it's a good idea to tear that out and try to restabilize that bank, only to come back and have something else go in there.
I'm just concerned with kind of a message that would be left with here.
So if we poured a concrete foundation, we should just leave it there, for instance? If we poured concrete stairs, we should just leave them there? And because we didn't want to follow the process like everyone else has to? That's kind of the point here, too.
I kind of feel like it's a stall. Sort of stalling just to keep it going until the
summer's over?
Yeah.
Well, I assure you it's not a stall, because we've done everything that the commission has asked right up to this point here, where you said come back and revise your mitigation plan to take everything out. So I've given you a protocol that would address that, where if you had to take the steps out, how we would do that, how we would stabilize that bank. But I think it's just counterproductive and counterintuitive.
You say we, but you weren't involved.
Frankly, I'd like to hear the homeowners in their own words kind of how this happened from my perspective. You're coming in kind of after the fact. I mean, I'd like to understand, get my hands around kind of how it happened and
why,
you know, where the miscommunication was.
And that the email correspondence explains sort of how it happened. And there was some misinformation on the Giswaldi's move. But then there, they looked around the dock and thought that they didn't realize that getting a float required another permit.
This is
vegetation cutting? I don't have an explanation for that. But
I went back and looked at the original footage for the, I think it was May 15th, 2014. Mm. And the gentleman who was proposing the plans, they had moved in the conservation monuments to be installed further in towards the house when they were working on it, so that nothing would be disturbed beyond that point. And to me, that is a clear message of people understand that they cannot go beyond these 30 feet apart, 7 proposed conservation monuments with plaques. That's quotes from that original meeting when waivers were given for them to even start building that.
So, I mean, I want to see the situation corrected, and ultimately that's the goal. But I think, you know, DEP's recommendation on these kinds of things is bring it back to its original state, then go from there, right? And not necessarily just, wave your hand and approve what's already done. It kind of gives a very poor message to anyone. It's like, well, just don't apply for permits, don't go through, follow the rules like everyone else has to, and they'll just approve it anyway in the end. I mean, we've had situations like that occur, and we're certainly trying to avoid
that. On ponds in particular as well.
Right. So, I mean, that's kind of, you know, the methodology we're trying to use here. It's not out of the blue. We're trying to follow DEP's protocol on this.
You know, I've been doing this over 25 years. Frankly, I'm not familiar with that protocol. I am familiar with bringing people into compliance. It's not uncommon that people file an after-the-fact notice of intent, because as we all know, any work within 100 feet of a wetland resource area needs either a negative determination or an order of conditions. So there are countless situations where people file after-the-fact notices of intent to bring themselves into compliance. This is a situation, the property borders on Rock Pond. It's a great pond. It's jurisdiction of the Commonwealth. On great ponds, people have the right to utilize the water. They could fish, boat, swim. And it would certainly be a permittable project to come to this commission in the right sequence of events and ask to get a float.
I don't disagree. In the right sequence of events, I don't disagree at all.
And ultimately, that will happen. There is an application. I've already filed an application to do just that, because I want to bring the Gesualdis back into compliance. I just think it's beneficial that we go out there as a commission and see the site. Let's have a discussion on site on the benefits of taking this out. Obviously, if you were to permit a float and access to it, I don't think you're going to suggest that we take a different path and cut more vegetation and restore this. So I'm fairly certain that in the near future, you're going to have to debate whether this is an appropriate methodology to get down to the pond. And I understand that it sets a bad precedent. If there's a fining mechanism, perhaps that's appropriate, but I just don't see the logic of pulling the steps out, restoring the bank, and coming back to you and putting steps or some other mechanism back in there, in the very same spot.
Can we ask Steve for his observations?
Your inputs, sir.
I think some of the restoration plans they mentioned are up to kind of the standards of the EO requirements. I would just disagree. They were submitted, but a couple of times they were not complete restoration, it was just partial. So I think there are some aspects of delays in the required EO dates. As far as the site walk, to be honest with you, I'd recommend against it. This is a discussion, not a notice of intent. I don't think it's necessarily an ideal way to gain information. That's more of a notice of intent process.
Well, there's still an open order of condition, so.
There is, but that was closed out and an OOC was issued. So at this point, it's typically just the agent going out, kind of looking for compliance. When I find violations, I bring it back to you.
Can I ask what you would recommend?
The OOC was already closed out on?
No.
Oh, I thought you just said it was closed out.
Nope.
It was issued.
It was issued,
and it's still open.
I think what he means is we closed the hearing.
Correct.
Right.
Correct. The notice of intent was.
Right.
Process was over.
Can I ask what your feeling would be about removing the stairway, how we would approach that?
I mean, I think you have the potential for short-term impacts related to it. But the long-term benefits, where if you could find a more gentle approach for going down there, long-term would be beneficial. It's a fairly steep area. If we permitted it early on, we could have looked at maybe like a boardwalk or some raised platform that might have done the exact same thing with less impact.
And what about stabilizing that slope while it's being removed and restored?
It's going to take some effort to assure that it keeps and doesn't erode down, but it's doable. Especially if they kind of do check.
Would it be more invasive than leaving it?
In the short term, yes.
What are we talking short term?
Well, the short term.
I guess I want to know how long the short term is.
Yeah, I mean, it was a growing season for it to take. I mean, the pictures that they sent around, they say there's grass growing. It almost looks like they put, lawn grass down there.
It is lawn grass.
This isn't native grass coming through after they cut the area. That looks more to me like lawn grass. Again,
but there certainly is native pepper bush coming in through there as well.
Correct.
But
that wouldn't need to be disturbed when those stones are removed.
Correct.
They could be continuing to regenerate.
So, I mean, that grass took in, a month and a half, 2 months? If you put a native seed mix and redid that whole area, within a month or two, it'd be pretty stable, especially if it was well-cared.
That was seeded earlier in the season, and you're not going to get those type of seeding results at this time. I'm not sure why there's such an aversion to come back out to the site. I mean, this is a very serious issue for the homeowners. It's a costly issue, and really, I would ask the commission to come out to the site and take a look at this, because I think once you see it, you'll agree that it makes sense to let the bank continue to stabilize as it is now. As Steve just said, there is, if you try to pull that out and restabilize it, there is going to be some short-term danger.
Potential.
There will be. If you have an area that you pull out what's stabilizing it now and then try to get grass to grow on a slope, there's always potential. You get the next rainstorm, there's potential to wash it all into the pond.
I guess I'm looking at the longer. Yeah, exactly. First. I'm looking at the much longer and larger issue of residents, doing this sort of thing all around both of our ponds that we have, and we need to make sure that it doesn't continue, because we've had a number of issues with work being done very close to the ponds, quite destructive work, and it's not okay.
Yeah, and I think the bylaw.
That's a much larger
around the pond notification.
Exactly.
We normally would have to waive that in the hearing.
And is it a 200-foot setback from the pond? I mean, we granted some serious waivers for this house alone, just the house, which, gosh, I made the motion to let them have that window in their house.
I did see
I'm kind of cranky.
That, yeah.
Yeah, so we can't continue to have people just do anything willy-nilly around the ponds when they're a very sensitive environment. They need protecting, and they're not being protected well at the moment. I'm also wondering, where was the harbor master for Rock Pond seeing a new dock going in that needed a permit? I'm also wondering, where was the company's questioning of the homeowners when they installed that dock? Do you have a permit for this dock? And I'm wondering if we should be finding the people who actually installed the dock not having checked to see whether it was permitted or not.
I think it's probably, you look in there, I would imagine it's very similar to tree services. They kind of leave it up to the homeowner.
How many times do we see people who have companies coming in,
sure,
cutting down trees, putting in docks, doing construction in areas where they shouldn't, and they have never asked?
I think it's important. I mean, I understand your concern, but I do think it's important, if you're saying you want to have the maximum protection for the pond, as I said, I cannot sit here and recommend that you take that stuff out and then try to restabilize the bank. And that's why I think it's important that, as a commission, we go out there and we see the conditions now. We evaluate what could happen if those steps were removed. So I'm asking that the commission schedule a site visit and take a look at this.
Surely there's a way to stabilize it by sort of terracing kind of the way down that slope and vegetating in the terraces.
You've got to get the vegetation time to transplant. And it's in the fall season, you don't get much root growth. So
there are ways. We're not talking about a 30-acre site all sloping downhill. Mm. I mean, you could put the bales of hay, like the wattles, crane check dams, and matting over it.
Switchbacks type of thing.
Yeah, I mean, we're not talking enormous area. Is it possible? Of course it is. It's not that big of a deal.
Right.
Is it the ideal time of the year? No, but we're trying to work with the time that we have.
Right. And I'm very hearing Rachel very, very clearly that the minutes were very explicit in terms of what the agreement was, and that the owners should have understood, and I'm sure they did understand what the limitations of that site were.
It was very clear.
So, I mean, I'll ask again, do commissioners want to go down there? It's up to you and up to us as a commission. Do individual commissioners want to go with Steve? I'm not saying you have to. If you want to, you can.
So that's basically going to put it off for another month.
Well, that means the EO is still in force unless we want to modify it as a commission.
They're pretty much asking the commission to reconsider the decision they made at the last meeting. The last meeting, it was discussed, it was decided on, it was voted on.
We decided in EO, it's in force right now.
I am, I'm asking you to reconsider that, and I'm asking you to come out to the site, because I don't see the rush here, since the best time to plant is after September 1. So I don't see the harm in convening for a site visit at the site, evaluate the conditions as they are today, and make an informed decision.
What's the alternative? We hold them to our original?
Well, we can let the EO ride as it is if the commission so desires, or you can modify it.
You don't have to make any decision tonight. I'll just say, we're not going to make any changes to this, and it stands as it is. I mean, you could always extend it if you're worried about the plants taking at that time of the year.
That could be a modification to extend the date. And again, the commission can modify an EO, no limit on the number of times it can do that. So
we can let it ride and then forgive some of the fines later. Right. There's different ways of handling it.
The best course of action is to come out and see the property. I mean, I don't understand why you'd want to not consider the facts as they are today before you make a decision.
Because we understand the facts are something other than your concern with the facts. Our facts are that this work was done clearly in a way and a place where it should never have been done. Those are our facts, and you all are working with different facts. For me, those are the facts. I don't know
but
about
if
you
our,
all.
If our
those
goal
are
is
my
to stabilize,
facts.
If our goal is to stabilize the banking and make sure it doesn't erode into the pond, Steve's already said, yes, there's short-term danger. Yes, it's not
potential,
the ideal time of
potential
year.
Potential danger.
The goal
potential
isn't just danger. To prevent erosion. The goal is to restore, too. That's part of the goal, too.
But also, we can't ignore that there's a notice of intent filed
way after the fact.
Yep. But to propose the very same thing. And it's an approvable project. There's no question about it. Everybody else around the pond has access. They have a float, and they have access to it. It's an approvable project.
But the access would be completely different if it were to come before us. It would be,
I've heard the comment that there's no other way to do this more environmentally friendly, and that this is an extremely environmentally friendly technique. That's, in my opinion, not the case.
Right.
They can have that view, but there are always better ways of doing it.
Right.
But there was never an opportunity for discussion on what the commission would prefer. They did what they wanted. Right. And now they're saying it's the only way, it's the best way. I don't think that's ever the case. I mean, there's always options. We're also running very far over as far as this.
Yes. So, I mean, again, it's up to the commission. It's up to the commission's pleasure. Do you want to leave the EO as it stands? Do you want to make the modification in terms of the date? Do you want to do a site walk? Again, this is a commission decision.
I would hope that you would extend it for, you know, just push the time frames out a month and do a site walk just so we can have see the site as it is.
You know, I'd recommend I'd recommend keeping the EO as it is, and at the end readdressing, see how it goes through the whole process, and then address, you know, forgiving. I mean, we can keep pushing this out and keep moving it. If there's non-compliance, you know, you just keep moving it till there is compliance. That's kind of a tip. I mean, EO stays in place. You know, just come back later and say, okay, well, we're going to grant them a month. They worked with us. We'll forgive that month and a half of fines.
So the dates that were in place in here were the restoration plan was to come to us by this meeting, and we do have a restoration plan, and that the float should have been removed by today.
Correct.
And due to their warranty issues, etc., they're saying that they need another 6 weeks before the float can be pulled.
So if this is just a quick question, I'm just throwing this out. If this is a non-permanent float, how do you propose to take it out in the winter? Are they not going to do that? I mean, what was the plan?
Well, they would have taken it out.
But if you can't, you know, if you can never get this company to do this, I mean, how would that all work?
The company's on a schedule, and they put the residential floats in early. They go off to their commercial work, and then they come back at the end of the boating season and service their residential clients.
Okay.
Can I make a motion that we leave the EO stand the way it is?
Sure can.
I propose that we leave the EO as it stands for 6 Heather Road. Do I need numbers and stuff here?
No.
Okay.
Is there a second for the motion?
Second.
We have a motion, and it's been seconded to leave the EO for 6 Heather Road as it was originally written and modified at the last hearing. Is there any further discussion?
Yes, I think there is one point that I need to bring up, and I alerted you when we talked about the date to remove the float that we were reliant on another company, and you told me communication is key.
Mm-hmm.
And so as soon as we found that we could not meet that date, we communicated with the commission. So hopefully that aspect of the EO would be considered.
I can put that in the notes.
Do you do we need to amend it to accept the date that they've proposed?
Well, I guess you could do it, again, you could do it either way. You could do it, you could leave the date and then forgive it.
Right.
When it actually comes to fruition, or you could modify it. I mean, both ways get the same.
Correct. I think sometimes it's easy just to keep it and forgive it later.
Okay.
Because we have 15 different versions of different EOs, and you have to start chasing dates
right.
and calculating different fines, and it gets very confusing.
Okay.
Now I have another question. Are you intending, or is the commission intending, to make another motion for a site visit, or was that
I'll
the extent
the,
of your motion?
Let's get through this one, and then we'll go to the next one. Any further discussion on that?
No.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? All abstaining. I'll entertain a motion for a site walk. Yay, nay?
I don't think so, in my opinion, especially after the comments that Steve made. And I know Steve's been out there, and we have the photographs.
Now, I will say, since there is an active order of conditions, a commissioner could go out with Steve if they so desired, as long as they have the permission of the
at any time
the landowner anytime. So even if we don't schedule a site walk, that does not prohibit any commissioner from wanting to go out there, and I would throw that out if they want to do that.
since
I'm not seeing a motion for a site walk,
I don't understand why the rush here, since we still have time in the planting season. I just don't understand why the commission is so averse to just coming out and seeing the site. I really don't.
I'll come out with Steve sometime next week.
But I'd like to be there when you come out. But I'd really encourage the rest of the commission to come out and take a look, because it's not like the pictures that you saw earlier. It's a very stable site. And I think you need to see that as you consider whether or not the enforcement action is appropriate.
Well, when that time is set up, that time and date can be communicated to the commission if other commissioners want to go,
and
then
we'll
they can go, and you can let Mr. Manuel know too.
Okay.
When you want to go.
I'll sign up.
I may go.
Lovely.
Too, Steve. What I wanted to really do was look at the just the whole size of that, the boulder system that's in there too, that has to be relocated.
So I mean, since it's not an NOI, we don't have really that kind of same. We're free to go out and essentially do a site walk as long as there's no permission issues with the property owners.
Okay,
and
I can
coordinate.
I'll set that up next week.
Okay.
Or I should move on. We have a
backlog
already.
So
I'm a little confused here, because I respect your schedule, but I'm a little confused that the terms of the enforcement order remain in place, but you may go out there and decide that it's appropriate to do another.
Well, no single commission. Again, a commission has to do things as you're fully aware, as a commission. A commissioner can have an opinion. They can go out there, and two commissioners can go out there and say, we want to do something different, but it's still your own place.
But that's why I think it's important to have people view it and then reconvene at a meeting and discuss it.
Well, that's not what the commission just voted, so I hear you. I think we're going to leave it like it is at the moment, unless the commissioner wants to make another motion.
I think it'd be worthwhile for another commissioner to make a motion to continue this matter for another month, and that way we are assured we're going to get the best solution.
So your goal is for us to come out, have a look at it, admire how pretty it is and how lovely it is, and then we'll change our minds.
My goal is to have you see the current conditions, because I believe professionally that to tear it out and try to start again is the wrong approach. I get, as I said, we're going to go around in circles again. I get the fact that you're not happy with me sitting here asking to allow the Jaswalski to have it remain in place. But professionally speaking, to have you tear out the steps at this time of year and try to reestablish the slope is not the way to go. And I want you to see that.
Well, as I said, I've asked the commission whether they want to do a site walk. A couple of commission have shown some interest. I think that's as much as you're going to get right now. We're way behind in terms of this discussion, since this isn't a hearing, and I've got a whole bunch of hearings, so we do need to move on. So the best I can...
Would anyone be interested if I made a motion for a site walk? Would anybody be interested in going out? We can just have a look.
I'm not going to go.
No? No.
I'd have to ask why. Why would you not be interested in seeing the site that you're voting on?
Because I think she's absolutely correct. Your intent is to get us out there and work on our emotions as opposed to what the facts are here. And I just don't think that's appropriate.
Go ahead, Nick.
And I think the whole idea is to put this back the way it was. I think we pretty well have the feeling that this was done on purpose, you know, and to allow it to continue like this is not a good message to the rest of the community. I think it needs to be put back the way it was. And yes, the short term we might suffer, you know, some erosion, but long term it's probably the best thing for the pond and the community.
Second.
Was that a motion?
No.
Yeah, we don't need a motion. We do need to move on.
I was just being fresh.
No, so I mean, essentially, the commission has kind of revoted, and that's where it stands at this time. As I said, we have to kind of move on.
Right.
We can revisit this any future meeting. And again, if commissioners want to, VST, contact you and go out there, they certainly can do that. Any commissioner can, and we can pick up that discussion again. But right now, we're kind of just spinning our wheels in that sense.
So, as you know, I have filed a notice of intent, and there is a requirement for a notification to all owners around the pond. And
when we open that hearing, we would then make a motion if the commission so desires to waive that.
Yeah, it's a little premature at this point to talk
about
that.
Right, that's where I'm going with that. We wouldn't do that now because the hearing's not open.
Could I just suggest that given our concerns about all the activity around the pond, that would not be something I would be interested in.
Again, we're kind of way ahead of us.
I understand. I'm just trying to be helpful.
Yep, I understand. No problem.
Is this matter continued to the next meeting?
Well, as far as discussion, if more discussion needs, it can certainly be continued, absolutely. Again, it's not a hearing. Not this part of it.
Typically, new information or something has changed that requires an update. At this point, I was not planning on putting this back on the agenda. This was kind
of
scheduled to discuss the restoration.
I was thinking only in terms of if commissioners happen to go out there and they wanted to bring it up again.
If that happens, I can put it on a discussion.
Yeah, a point of discussion, absolutely.
But at this point, it's coming off the agenda until something changes and needs to be discussed.
I think I'd like to request that we be on the agenda for the next meeting just so we can reconvene after people actually come out and visit the site.
So noted, but we do have to kind of move on at this point. We are getting really behind.
So the 7 o'clock, the applicant's looking for
Thank
a continuation
you.
So we could skip to the next one. Street.
But we still have to open that.
We can come back.
Yeah.
There's no one coming for it, so we can do it.
So make sure that we come.
If
we do.
I'll make sure you guys bounce back to that.
Thank
you
for your time.
Thank you.
Thank you.
It being on or after 7:10 p.m., I am going to open a new notice of intent for Pond Street, GCC 2015-08, DEP 161-0806. That's removal of existing chain link fence and installation of highway guards along both sides of the pond adjacent to Pentucket Pond. If I could have the applicant and our consultant, and if you could identify yourself for the record, please.
Mr. Durkee with the Georgetown Highway Department.
Brian Sullivan with Bayside Engineering.
Thank you.
Sir.
Is that a whole pond notification? As we're on the topic.
Absolutely.
It is?
It was.
A butter notification for the entire pond?
It's a butter notification for what the assessor gave us. It's not for the whole pond.
Within 300 feet?
Within 300 feet, yes.
But I think our bylaw, we would have to waive.
Correct.
Okay.
Our bylaw says you got to notify around the pond any kind of major activity going that people can visually see, and you know, the whole thing really was about, you know, people chopping trees down, all of a sudden they look out their window and their view has changed. So
this is a 300-foot notification to abutters.
So the commission would need to vote.
We need to waive it.
Whether they want to waive it or not, that requirement.
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to make a motion that we waive the full pond abutter notification for the Pond Street Project, GCC 2015-08.
Second.
There's a motion, and it's been seconded, to waive the full pond notification for the notice of intent for the Pond Street fence removal. Is there any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
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 All opposed? All abstained. Okay. Proceed.
Okay, so Peter Durkee and the Georgetown Highway Department has retained Bayside Services to draw plans to replace the existing fence along Pond Street on both sides with proper crash-tested guardrails. Basically, what that entails is the removal of the existing fence and posts and the installation of a W-beam steel highway guard with wooden posts. No wooden posts?
No, it's side beam.
It is beam. Currently, there is a 6-foot and a 4-foot chain link fence along Pond Street on both sides. On the westerly side of the road, the 6-foot fence continues about 400 feet, 400 or 500 feet, and then it drops down to 4 feet in a northerly direction. On the east side of the road, it is a 6-foot fence, basically along the back sidewalk on that side of the road. The existing fence terminates at 67 Pond Street. W-beam highway guard, the detail that we provided is the standard detail that MassDOT uses. It's a tried and tested method. The face of the guardrail is 4 inches off the edge of the pavement, and the break in the slope is 24 inches behind the guardrail. That's necessary to achieve that crash test rating on that guard.
Is it this one? Is that the kind of guardrail that you're talking
about?
It's
exactly the kind of guardrail.
Right, okay.
Removing the fence, the existing fence is a barrier to wildlife. It separates the existing pond bank with the vegetated wetland downstream, the vegetated wetland that is bordering the Parker River. We believe that removing the fence while making the roadway much safer will also protect the resource area much more and provide better wildlife connectivity. Currently, chain link fence will not hold a car on the road. I checked the DEP comments on this, and there was no comment. They reviewed the notice of intent and had no comment. Checked it online before I came to the meeting. So
could you just review the installation of the new guardrail? Are they having to dig those posts in? Or are they pounding them in? How are they doing that?
They pound the post in. So there will be really hardly any disturbance to the earth on that slope. They just come by and pound each I-beam into the ground.
Now the existing fence, I'm sure, has some probably concrete posts that need to be dug out.
We plan on taking the fabric off the fence,
mm-hmm.
and reusing that at another location, and we'll put a chain or a slip tie onto the post and pull the post out, and then fill it back in. So we're not going to be digging the post up.
I'm assuming you're going to use guardrail that's up to the DOT code. I don't know if you're aware of some of the controversy of some of the end pieces that were causing impalements and such.
Yep.
One of the contractors changed the design and ended up seriously impeding the safety factor of those things. So
you've seen the pictures.
Yeah.
So you're not messing with. Sorry, you're not messing with the culvert at all. It's just the fence.
The fence, there's already a guardrail at the culverts on both sides, so we'll take the fence down, leave that existing guardrail.
And will the guardrail then go the exact length of that where the fence is at now?
Yes.
Now, question, there's fence on both sides of the road. You're just taking the fence off on the...
On both sides.
On both sides. All right.
Is it a safety issue to leave it on the culvert because it's a drop-off? Mm-hmm.
There are screens at the flume.
Just curious. I was kind of presuming the fence was going to stay at the culvert and just be replaced everywhere else.
You mean at the culvert or the dam?
The dam. I'm sorry. Yeah. I just thought it was kind of a safety issue. That was to keep people out of the dam area so they don't fall in and have safety issues. Because a lot of this, the car that's being, it's a safety issue, most of all. This fence is not safe, so it's reasonable to replace it. As long as it's, and it's more worried about erosion and things like that, which Peter is definitely taking care of.
What about other dams in town that have this kind of...
That's are the only dam in town.
Oh, that's the only one. I was thinking of the one by King Street. That's not the same.
I mean, this just has a drop, a larger... To me, it seems like a significant drop that you... But if they're not worried, it's not really a conservation-related issue.
Right.
It's just not
no.
Mm-mm.
And there's no sidewalk along there, is there?
On the opposite side of the pond,
there's a sidewalk.
Yes.
So I met with Peter on site just to get a feel for what they're doing. There's a few spots where erosion is occurring actively, so they're going to kind of clean up those areas and do a little bit of grading to improve and prevent future erosion. But aside from that, the project's kind of neutral environmentally.
I mean, your point from the safety factor is well taken. I mean, with a dam with a drop, you have the concept of a deadhead dam. Actually, they cause a lot of drownings in larger situations because if you get caught in that circular current, it just keeps sucking you down over and over again.
And I'm sure Peter can check on that. It's not a conservation-related issue,
right.
I'm
right.
sure.
Before there'll still be a guardrail
Correct.
Yes.
protecting it. So, yeah.
I was just thinking of the value of keeping the fence there.
Yeah. What kind of wildlife crosses over there, by the way?
I've rescued, numerous turtles.
Some
turtles I've rescued like this.
Snapping turtles.
They can't fit under the fence, so you're trying to
move
them, 100 yards down the road trying to get them back into the water.
I've seen them in the pond. They get big.
Yeah.
I don't have any real issues with it from an environmental standpoint.
No.
Peter will work with us in the field if there's any issues real time.
Is something anyone wants to, everyone seen this? Did anyone want to go out and do a site walk?
Much more aesthetically.
Yeah, I guess I could never understand how the fence got there in the first place.
I don't know either.
And, all of a sudden, how did the fence get there? It just grew up one day. Are there any abutters to the Pond Street project? If you want to comment, you are free as long as you identify yourself for the record, please.
Edward Powell Jr., 63 Pond Street. My parents abut the project directly across the street from me. And I see, like, the wildlife, the ducks, the turtles, they have no place to cross right now. As far as what's going on, I see no problems.
Mm-hmm.
I know the 6-foot fence is a real hassle. My father's got some real medical problems, and my parents cannot see coming out of the driveway. Mm-hmm. They have to drive to the other side of the road just to see a car coming down the road.
Mm. Very good, thank you. Anyone else want to make a comment? Positive, negative, or otherwise?
I just want to say it's about time.
I would agree.
We're here from 90 Pond Street, and we're here just in favor of the project.
Just if you could have your name just so we can put it on.
Elizabeth Rose.
Thank you.
Joe Holland from 90 Pond Street. We're in favor of this project.
Yeah, very good. Thank you. I think this was a popular project from the get-go.
Mm-hmm.
Again, I don't think we could even determine how the fence really got approved in the first place. It just kind of appeared. So, because I don't think the commission ever actually approved the fence. It just, when they rebuilt the dam, I think they just put it up.
Okay, Mr. Chairman, I'd like to make a motion to...
Sorry, just want to make a comment. We're really happy it's coming down. It's Joe and Linda Corker on Pond Street.
Thank you.
Jack Mulder had something to do with putting the fence up.
Right.
Just a rumor.
Yes, this is a true rumor. Sir, in the back.
Doug Gordon, 65 Pond Street.
Mm-hmm.
I'd like to thank Peter and the gentleman from Bayside for their work. Looking forward to having the completion of the project.
Very good. Thank you, sir.
We don't often have applause at our meetings.
Never do. On both
sir?
Sides of the table.
How soon before you start?
Go ahead, sir.
Joe Hall, 90 Pond Street. I think the big issue in my mind is aesthetics. This is the ugliest fence in a very beautiful area that you could imagine putting there. So we are much in favor of getting rid of it and having a secure garden.
Yeah.
So those people might have a view again as they either walk by or drive by and not, you know, be looking through
mesh.
And I clearly think it's an improvement for the wildlife too. I mean, as I said, I've rescued so much wildlife trying to cross there, and had to, you know, stop the car, put the flashes on, and try to rescue the turtle and try not to get run over at the same time.
So we'll need wildlife crossing signs.
We should
now
have one, duck crossing or something.
I actually rescued a big turtle at one point, and who was driving by the other way? The Mass Environmental Police. So he put on his blues, and he says, "You're doing a good job." I said, "You should be out here."
Bayside does have a traffic department. We can do a stoplight there for the wildlife.
There's another comment.
Oh, one more.
Sorry.
Sure, ma'am?
Linda Corcoran on Pond Street. I'm wondering if there's a possibility that when the sidewalk is designed, if it isn't already, if it could be on a slope so that the turtles can, when they get to the other side of the street, they can get back up and across.
You weren't planning on
there
doing any regrading,
there's no plan,
right,
for sidewalk.
Yeah, we're just talking removal of fence.
And putting a guardrail.
Are you talking about the sort of curb that the turtles can't get up?
Right now it's a 45-degree angle, and if they had for a turtle, they could, you know, we wouldn't see so many turtles.
Right. Yeah, we've rescued a couple on National Ave who were trapped in that very deep and steep curb there, and they couldn't get out.
Well, I'm sure if Peter ever redoes the curbing there, he can modify it.
The only curbing that's there now is on the opposite the pond side.
Right, right.
I'm seeing a book, Make Way for the Turtles. Make Way for the Ducklings.
You can write that.
Can include a turtle crossing sign.
Mm-hmm.
I'll entertain a motion.
Yep.
If there are no more questions or comments.
I thought you started that.
I did. I'll continue. Okay. Mr. Chairman, I'd like to make a motion to approve the NOI for the Pond Street fence, which is GCC 2015-08, DEP 1610806.
A second.
We have a motion. It's been seconded to approve the notice of intent for Pond Street GCC 2015-08. That's the removal of the existing chain link fence. Is there any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? All abstaining. Motion carries.
There it is again.
Justice has been served.
And I'll entertain a motion to close the notice of intent.
Mr. Chairman, I move that we close the NOI for Pond Street Chain Link Fence, GCC 2015-08, TEP 1610806.
Second.
We have a motion, and it's for second to the close, a notice of intent for Pond Street, GCC 2015-08. Is there any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? All abstaining? The done deal, folks.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Great job,
this
guys.
This plan has a scale on it, the other one doesn't.
Oh, really? Good to know.
Bye. Nice to see you from afar.
Thank you.
Okay. And let's see, we have a continuation request for 269 Central Street?
Correct.
Well,
we can see it later if we have a, we already have a backlog of people waiting.
All right.
So.
It being on or after 7:20, I'm going to open up a new notice of intent for 75 West Main Street, GCC 2015-07. Installation of a concrete loading fuel containment pad, installation of concrete pad for a pair of emergency generators, installation of a new concrete sidewalk, and restoration of broken asphalt surfaces. If I could have the applicant and a consultant, if you could identify yourself for the record, please. And also, could I have green cards if you have them?
Barry Davies, Facilities Manager, Thompson Energy.
Russ Barton with Wilcox and Barton.
Chris Wood with Wilcox and Barton.
All right. Folks, why don't you run us through the project here?
So the facility is located at 75 West Main Street. It's Townsend Oil and Propane. Historically, they've provided home heating oil delivery services. They've got just over 70,000 gallons of oil storage on site. More recently, they installed an underground propane storage tank. Last year around this time, we identified some items that they'd like to make improvements at the site that require notice of intent, mostly with respect to resurfacing concrete and asphalt. The main office right here is a two-story wood structure building. The concrete dike with the above-ground storage tanks is located adjacent to it. There's a loading rack just to the north of the containment pad where trucks pull in, mm-hmm. get loaded from the top, from the big tanks, and then drive away to go to deliveries. This area here in front of the dike is currently is just limp pack or hard pack gravel. They'd like to make that a concrete containment pad. So if there's any incidental or accidental spillage during loading
is
the truck.
Is this going to be part of your SPCC plan?
Yes.
Correct.
Yep. So that's driven by SPCC regulations. So any spills would be redirected back into the containment dike.
Maybe you could submit that too as part of the package.
Yep. Yep. So we haven't done any in-depth design yet. We're still in the preliminary phases. That is a plan to create a profile view of that.
What's an SPCC plan?
SPCC is a oil spill prevention, control, and countermeasures,
countermeasures plan.
Yeah,
so if you have anything over 1,250 gallons above ground storage of petroleum products, you are required to have that plan in place. Which defines how you're going to respond to emergencies and spills.
Right.
And
that would be the dike we're talking about going around.
That's one. That's part. That would be part of it. That's the some of the engineering controls, as this would be, but the you know also
this is part of it also where the trucks would actually park.
Human element is included too, and it requires.
Besides the dark. Because
as of right now,
area.
It's a limb pack material. If the truck did rupture, it would actually get into that limb pack, and it wouldn't be controlled as well as it was on concrete. It would actually be a very hard controlled cleanup. Cleanup.
Sure. What do you mean lint pack? Is
lint
that
pack is
lint
like
cotton?
It's like soil.
Oh.
It's just soil. It's like ground up asphalt.
Gravel.
Oh, I
pack
see.
Gravel.
Does that happen very often?
No.
Okay. All right. Okay.
Mostly because the SBCC plans are in place.
Okay.
Yeah,
of course.
Yeah. Go ahead.
It's for if a major accident did occur. Say someone made a mistake in the yard. And a truck came in, hit the side of a fuel transport vehicle or something like that, offloading, unloading. It would give us that protection to where we could contain it and then clean it up properly. Where, as of right now, I mean, we're kind of on the fence. Yes, we haven't had an issue.
Oh, I see.
But not going with it.
So it's for big spills. It's not for like dribbles out of the bottom of the
ball. Little dribbles
actually
are
requires
covered.
Like monthly inspections to make sure those dribbles don't become problems.
Oh, I see.
And I mean, again, it's a comprehensive program that's supposed to require an employer that, you know, make sure you're anticipating spills and responding to them and preventing them.
Okay.
Right, so some of the physical improvements we're doing are part of the SPCC requirements. When we looked at the facility, did an inspection, we identified some of these items that should be upgraded in order to comply with federal regulations. And that some of those upgrades require notice of intent because we are within this 100
mm-hmm.
foot and 75 and even sometimes the 50 foot buffer zone.
Yes.
So besides the concrete pad that's proposed, they want to put a concrete sidewalk adjacent to the office building just for access. And then additionally, resurface this existing asphalt up Milton Way. This is Prospect Street, Main Street's over here. So from about here down to the corner of this access road and Milton Way, and then further up to the edge of the property line. Currently that's existing broken asphalt. So they just want to
same
resurface
footprint.
It. Yep, same, yep. So this is all paved right now, existing. I mean, some of it almost doesn't look paved anymore because of how broken up the asphalt is.
So the resource area is that kind of oblong area
yep,
there? Yep,
this little zigzaggy area is an identified wetland area.
Are we near the pond? Yeah. Is Milton Way on that driveway on the way to the pond?
Correct.
Yes.
It
the
is.
Wetland is underneath the power lines. To orientate you where you're going,
yeah.
That's under the wetland.
Yep.
The wetland's under the power lines.
Yeah, it's
line.
That bumpy road that you kind of go up
right.
past the facility, and it's kind of really, really broken up pretty bad, big hot potholes.
So a spill like that of oil or gasoline or whatever could travel a long way. Am I right
yeah,
in thinking
really
that? If you didn't
it.
Have that containment, it could
mm-hmm.
potentially
get,
especially,
the pond,
you know,
get
it's,
to
it's,
the pond.
It's yeah. a load. It's a loading rack, and it's all downhill. It would actually go into the wetland area, which we really want to prevent.
Right. Okay.
Go here.
Yeah, we're so at. We're at a.
Oh, it's graded down.
Yeah. We're at a 99.8, and then the wetlands, I believe, at 89. So
it
would all
go
down
to
the.
Oh,
wetland.
Wow,
it's almost impossible
big.
For it to go
it's
uphill
steep,
and go to the pond.
Yeah,
it's going to go towards that small isolated wetland before it hits
pitch.
The pond.
But what
yeah.
I mean is, when it goes underground,
yeah, once
it can seep underground.
It gets, yeah, right. If you have,
correct.
Or you have a, you know, a rainstorm and you have sheet runoff of the oil, so you can create a very expensive cleanup situation.
Yeah.
Quick question. Do you guys get DEP comments yet? When we checked earlier, there was no closeout in the DEP.
No.
So all that means we can't close it out tonight, but we can give feedback and,
mm-hmm.
you know, if everyone's okay with it, you know, just continue it.
If I may, to speak to your question regarding the groundwater, it is, groundwater actually flows away from the pond over there. So it flows towards that wetland area.
Oh, right.
So just another little bit of tidbit of information on the engineering side with respect to if there was to be a release to the environment, it would hit the groundwater. It does flow out radially a little bit, but it does end up flowing away from the pond.
That's great. Thanks.
So along those same lines, there are existing monitoring wells on the property. They're all the existing wells are identified. This plan is a little different than the plan that we submitted originally. We just wanted to include some proposed monitoring wells. Those are in areas where we've had wells in the past.
Now, let me ask a question. Are those wells just preventive, or have you had
releases
in the past?
They are required
that you're monitoring
for the MCP, so under 310 CMR 40.
Mm-hmm.
We're monitoring groundwater conditions at the site. So some of the wells that were destroyed just from you know, the broken asphalt plows going over, they'll pull the tops of the well covers off. That sort of thing. We're looking to replace just three wells.
So are the wells you're closing? Are you going to properly seal those per the DEP? You know,
we haven't been able to locate them. They are
so
gone.
because a well itself now can become a source of groundwater contamination if you don't close it properly, because
well,
you've got
a
shaft down.
Oh, when we close them
right.
out, when we close
yeah.
out the
yeah,
wells.
Yeah, if any wells are going to be decommissioned. Yeah, we'd follow the procedures.
Is there any plan to look for them while you're digging up the area? I mean, are you going to regrind that area and grade it before you? I mean, is there any potential to do a little digging at that time and try to locate them?
I'm assuming they'll cut to fill for the asphalt a little bit, just to kind of regrade everything. And when they do that work, we can
keep an eye
look for them. Yeah, hopefully we'll see the PVC sticking
especially
up.
On that back access road there.
because if we do anything there, I definitely want you to come out and show me what, because we talked about this in the past, mm-hmm. some things that you had in mind that you would like on that back access, mm-hmm. access road. You kind of wanted me to shrink the road up a little bit, plant some yep. vegetation in there. Yep. That, you know, so we're willing to do that. We just can't go all the way into that area. My boss doesn't really want to go off our site.
You legally can't.
Yeah, exactly.
But that's why.
Well, we reached out to National Grid. We sent them a letter, and they were willing to allow us to do some work over there. But it was kind of like one of those type of things where it's just like,
I've been working with these.
Someone else's property.
I've been working with these guys for a while.
Is your pad going to be coated with anything? Because obviously concrete is porous, and you know petroleum does kind of, if it's got cracks or anything, it does make a mess and can seep into the concrete itself. Are you going to coat it with anything?
It's actually a pitch, an extreme pitch, so any petroleum product would actually go directly into the diking area. The diking area is so thick that the from what I'm understanding is that it is sealed, the dike walls, or it didn't need to be. So I did ask the same question that was on my mind as well.
It's a great question. You know, we've gone through a couple design there, trying to get the right one for the usage of the property. You know, Barry and I will work together to try to design a system that really is designed to contain the spill. There's going to be a certain amount of pitch. There is a certain coating that's involved. But,
yeah, I've been involved in a number of hazardous waste design storage facilities, and you know, you normally want to exactly pitch them and have a collection point. And many times, you do want to coat the concrete if you can, only because different materials tend to, you know, seep into it. Now you've got to sclerify the concrete if you've got a situation.
The joints are all typically sealed by design. It's a really old dike, but it's a really thick dike, and so I mean, we're going to try to make sure that everything, you know, is contained. We'll have to make sure that everything is contained, and the goal is to try to get it back into the dike. We've had a couple different designs, and you know, you just haven't really settled on the one that's going to really work best for them, in the interest of not having to revisit it again later.
Steve, is this in NEH, ASP, National Heritage area? No.
It is not.
No.
Can I ask what would happen in the event of a large, like a 100-year, 500-year storm? Is that any kind of issue here?
Well, we pulled the reports on the.
Well, hang on. Just with respect to.
Well, flooding. And I don't know, taking material out of your bays or whatever. I guess I'm
okay, so
being a girl, I can't really.
I just want to understand the context.
Yeah, I'm not really sure.
Are you worried about their base filling up with water during a major rain event?
Yes,
and
I am.
And then overflowing with all these contaminants?
Yes, I am. That's exactly what I'm thinking.
So like Mother's Day flood, what would that do to this type of
situation? Dealt with it.
Like in has waste facilities, many times you'll actually have even a sump type pump.
That's exactly what we have.
You get rainwater in your collection point, and actually since it mixes with a little oil, then you end up with a bunch of hazardous waste.
Well, what we have here in this situation, it would be a skimmer. It would collect the oil, and so the oil wouldn't come off out of the dike. So if rainwater filled up in the dike, it would skim the oil. So the oil would be trapped in one location. Then the other area would just be water. So you wouldn't be able to pump out the oil. So the oil would be trapped in its own containment area.
We talked about
it's lighter. Oil floats on the top of the water.
So then you actually
skim it.
You take it off the top.
We take it off the top. The oil would flow into its own area, and then we pump out the water.
Okay, all right.
We have a similar thing in our Summersworth location, and that's how we do it there. We do the same system.
Part of the SPCC plan, one of the administrative controls or one of the practices that we prescribe is that if the containment dike does fill up with water, there's typically a drain, but it has to be visually inspected first to make sure there's no sheen or floating product on the water before it's discharged. So a lot of that's covered under there. The other thing to point out is that dike can contain over 70,000 gallons because of all of the tanks ruptured.
Were you here during the Mother's Day storm?
I was.
Wow. Well,
I
don't know if it would. Remember that?
Yeah. What's the revision date on this? Because this is not what we had in our file. Did you make some modifications?
This plan, the only
respect to the well.
Yeah, the only differences are the three proposed monitoring wells.
Okay. What's revision date?
This one. Oh, I didn't put a revision date on there.
It was today.
Originals.
Yeah.
We fixed it.
We put
today.
Those wells on today. Yeah. So, yeah.
Well, I think you make sure you submit that revised plan to us because we want to approve the final plan with the correct rev date. So
we can't close this out tonight.
Since we can't close it, and we're not necessarily making any changes, just when we do close it, make sure you submit that revised plan to us. And we'll close that plan.
How would you like to submit, electronically or hard copies?
Hard copy would be
24
ideal.
By 30.
Yeah, just one full size, please.
It was really an afterthought where we said, are we covering all our bases here? And we were focused on the construction related services, and we saw that, you know, we had a plan to do some monitoring well replacements because mm-hmm. some were lost, paved over, hit by the plows, and I said, well, let's get that on the plan so that they can see where we want them to go. So
yeah,
we've got them all.
I have no issue with the monitoring well. I just want to make sure we kept the right plan in the file if we go to look at it in the future.
Absolutely.
Could I ask one more question?
Sure.
I'm sorry. Is there any point to vegetating that area under the power lines? And I know it's not your property, but I know that there are certain ways to vegetate an area that will deal with contaminants and oils and things that. Would that be a good, like, overflow?
It would in
backup?
An ideal situation. I do know the rail trail's going through there eventually.
Oh.
So anything you plant is going to get cut down. And
right.
We got to deal with that wetland as far as access for the rail trail someday.
Okay.
It's not an ideal spot for it. I've been working with them for over a year trying to do exactly that.
Okay.
Yes.
It's a tight spot. They need certain access that they have right now. They can't give up. I was trying to get them to give up some of that road so they could plant some vegetation, and
mm-hmm.
we've been over it.
And we worked on that with the plan with Steve, and you know, we agreed with it at first, too.
In concept, but
the concept
just couldn't
was
make it work.
Was.
I mean, this is kind of unlike other situations, is that you know, you're having an impact fairly close, but the whole reason of the impact is to prevent potentially a major spill and major damage.
It's an improvement. It's an improvement.
Right.
It's a tight spot. Again, I worked for a while trying to, 6 inches of vegetation. You'd almost impact their safety of room to get through, and
right.
By doing it, it might.
What we're
create
trying to do really is protect the public. If there
yeah.
ever was an issue, if something did happen, we want full containment. We don't want to be able to have to. If we didn't have enough staff on site, we want a full containment system. We don't want to have people trying to contain a 10,000 gallon offload, which would be almost impossible. It really would be. It's not something that anyone wants to see. So. What we'd like to do is we want to get it done as soon as possible. That's why we were trying to get these plans going and get everything submitted to you as soon as possible so we can get this protection in. It's really just protection. It really is.
Is there a backup power source? You talked about the dike area, and if the power went out and it's filling up.
Our idea is in the back right-hand corner far wall, we'd like to put a generator system in.
Propane?
Would be a propane oil. Generator because they're quieter. Diesel generators create a lot of noise. So we would like to run a propane generator because they're extremely quiet. If it did kick on in the middle of the night to turn on a pump or something, the propane generators really don't make as much noise. Again, diesel generators is extremely noisy, and they turn on periodically.
It's going to be like a diesel truck. I've dealt
yeah.
enough with
oh,
diesel
yeah.
fire pumps
yeah.
and diesel generators. I mean,
you know.
Actually use truck engines. In
yeah.
many cases.
And the other thing too, with the rear gate with that being open, then we could allow our trucks being paved to come through those back
yeah,
back
gate,
roadway.
Right.
As of right now, we can't. A lot of the issues are, you know, the springs on our truck and our equipment with some of these potholes that are actually in that roadway. Sometimes that we tell our drivers not to go that route because of the damage that occurs to our equipment. And again, we don't want something to happen to one of our trucks that we spent a lot of money on. And then having an issue with the truck breaking down the road or causing damage, further damage to that back roadway. You know, because a lot of the people like to use that back road to go to the pond. And, the,
mm-hmm.
and as you guys know, if you go there, that back roadway is pretty tough shape.
It's going to make the
it
rest
is.
Of it look worse now. You're going to improve the first half.
Yeah.
yeah.
No.
You can gun it along
yeah,
there
be,
and then fall in a
yeah,
big
exactly.
hole.
Yeah,
exactly.
After the propane tank.
So you're not really expanding on anything. You're just replacing what's already
yeah.
there.
Yeah, resurfacing.
And
improving.
Improving
and
surfacing.
Protecting. Looks
yeah.
good.
So there's
like
not
it.
Much that we can do tonight then, right?
Well, basically, we either, you know, if we like what we see, we're not going to tell them to make any changes to this plan.
Okay.
We just have to wait for comments, and then the next meeting we can approve it.
And if there's no
and
issue.
And I'll open it up for a butter comment.
And if there are no real outstanding issues, they almost don't even have to come in. It's kind of an administrative
right.
process.
So I'll ask, are there any changes any commissioners want to see on the plan as proposed? None being noted, I'll open it up to abutter comments or any abutters to this project on 75 West Main Street. Sir, if you want to make a comment, or you don't have to if you don't want, don't do, but I just throwing it out there.
Just curious.
So I think the only outstanding is just to get a copy of this current plan at your convenience. And the next meeting is August 20th.
We're waiting for DEP comments, is that right?
Yes.
And I'll have it kind of pre-written and get voted inside that night, so.
And yeah, again, make sure we get the plans.
The updated plan.
Updated plans, right.
You just to be clear, you did make a reference to seeing some design plans on the spill containment, is that?
Yeah, I'd actually like to see your plan, your SPCC plan. I mean, it should be.
Oh, the plan itself?
Yeah.
Okay.
The document.
So one of us will know what it is and as they read it.
No, is that the one that we already have?
I have seen a few and written a few in my time.
Good point. Yeah.
And that one in?
That person's not me, by the way. Just to be clear.
The plan, not the blueprint of some things that we've already designed.
Right. Okay. Once we do the design and once we get the approval and we do the construction, we'll revise the SPCC plan and you'll have a copy of the plan submitted.
Okay, so that's not something you do beforehand. That's kind of after.
Yes.
I'm not familiar. I'm just trying to make sure.
We're doing right. We're doing the SPCC, it has to be what the existing conditions are, not what it is going to be. It's kind of prepared in draft, so it exists, but we notice that, you know, we know that we need to make that improvement. So once we make the improvement, then we'll finalize the plan and we'll send you guys a copy.
Okay.
Awesome.
That's fair enough.
So we're just looking for continuation to August 20th.
August 20th is the date. Take a motion.
I make a motion that we continue to August 20th meeting for the 75 West Main Street GCC 2015-07 DEP number 161-0807.
7 o'clock, please.
7 o'clock.
I second.
We have a motion and it's been seconded to continue the notice of intent for 75 West Main Street to August 20th at 7 p.m. Is there any further discussion? Favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? All abstained.
Thank you very much.
Thank you
very much.
Thank you.
I'll be in touch with you. Right.
Looks good.
You don't need that plan. I can take that, and then you don't have to send.
Well, I've got one downstairs that doesn't even have any wrinkles in it. If you
I don't mind the wrinkles. Not that prissy. It'll just save you having to mail something if you don't mind.
Thank you.
Thanks.
You're welcome. It being on or after 7:30, I'm going to open up a new notice of intent for One Industrial Way, GCC 2015-09. Project entails the restoration of wetlands, the removal of existing freestanding block walls, and the erection or erosion control barriers to be located 50 feet from the restored wetland and the placement of approximately 100 feet of precast blocks the southwest corner of the storage stockpile. If I could have the applicant and or consultant, and if you could identify yourself for the record, please.
Mr. Chairman, Richard Nyland, on behalf of the applicant.
Thank you.
With me, Paul Marchanda, and the owner, Steve Crusoe.
Thank you. And do you have any green cards for us?
Yes, we do.
Thank you.
Paul has those.
Did I get one of those? They go to Susan.
Yeah.
We can take care of that.
No, that's okay. I'm sorry. I don't want that.
Oh, super. Actually, could you hand that to Susan, too, as well? Thank you. She gets everything, all the detail stuff.
So, Mr. Chairman, if I can just put this in context, as I mentioned when I was here, I guess it was last month, we had been under an enforcement order for some time with respect to the block wall that was out there as well as the fill of wetlands. We'd always agreed that we were going to restore the wetlands and replicate in addition and we had discussions for a long time with respect to the block wall. We'd indicated to you that it was placed primarily as a sound barrier and also to protect the wetland area, and we thought it was functioning, but after looking at the how it was, would have to be moved and what that was going to do to operations, we ultimately concluded, and since we're also not entitled to have it as a matter of right, we'd have to ask for a waiver. But the best thing to do was just to get rid of the block wall, remove it, and to restore the area similar to what was approved in 1996 in terms of where the wetlands were in the buffer zone. So that's why, after all that discussion, what you're seeing in front of you, we're hoping the Conservation Commission is happy that this wall will be off of your table, but that's our intention, is to then operate the facility without that block wall. And then Paul will talk about the resource area. We had a wetland scientist prepare a pretty comprehensive restoration plan for the wetland. And so that's what we're here to discuss, those two items in notice of intent. One is the restoration. The second is the removal of the block wall. And I'm not even sure we need to get permission to remove that, but I thought it was appropriate to include it in the notice of intent. So with that, unless you have any procedural questions, I'm just going to have Paul walk you through.
Go ahead, proceed.
So what I have here, Mr. Chairman, this is a plan of the site right now. And what you see here in the cross-sets areas, the wetland areas that were being restored back to the 1996 levels, as agreed upon on the March 19th hearing we had here, or not hearing, meeting we had here. And we decided that between, instead of leaving it non-wetland, we'd create some wetlands by having a replicated wetland area.
So is that in addition to what we discussed before?
No, I think we discussed, I think we talked about the one.
Okay.
And then, as Attorney Nyland said, both these block walls will be removed. Then the area would be graded up from the wetland grade to the yard grade at a very gentle slope. I think the steepest slope is like 8-1, like between 8-1 and 10-1. So it's a very flat slope. And actually, if you look at the cross section we prepared, what we've talked about doing is having a very flatter slope, 10-1, adjacent to the replicated wetland before we start sloping up at like 8-1, which is a little bit steeper. So it's a very gentle sloping area, much unlike what's there now today, which is that steep slope down to the the wetlands. This is the blow up of the area. So that would, pretty much what would happen, these block walls would come out, this erosion control barrier would be in place, we'd place 50 feet away from the edge of the now restored and replicated wetlands. So there wouldn't be any activity in the future taking place within 50 feet of the wetlands as there is today. And really, that's pretty much it. As Trin Island said, we'll give you a very detailed report on how to restore these wetlands in terms of soil conditions and plantings, shrubberies and trees being planted, wetland seed mix being put in this entire area, and then a conservation mix behind the erosion control barrier. So really, it's quite simple as far as I can see. I'm happy to answer any questions that you have. And
don't take this the wrong way, but this is kind of what we were asking for. We had a lot of discussion, and I guess the discussion centered around a lot that it wasn't possible initially, but you've somehow come up with this is a
whole new
solution. Well, let me just say that it was a very difficult decision for, because it is going to impact how he operates his business. He's going to have to really change how he operates his business, but it wasn't an easy decision, but it was one that we made, and we just want to bring us to the end. So.
Well, it was always we were either going to remove the wall or move it as far as we could. I mean, we always said that it was difficult to operate with that wall if we had to move it. Mm-hmm. But removing the wall has been something that we've talked about. We didn't want to do it because we thought that it had a greater value as a sound barrier and protecting the wetland. But ultimately, we can't do both. That's where we came to.
What is the erosion control barrier?
It's a silt fence and also a silt sock type.
So it's not permanent?
Well, it is permanent.
But a silt fence, that's
impermanent.
Hold on.
depending on the hay bales or the recycled wood chip, socks would break down.
So that siltation barrier, I mean, this looks so much better, really does. I'm just wondering about the permanence of that siltation barrier, because we were in agreement that one of the benefits of the wall was that it actually prevented runoff into the wetlands. So I'm just, and encroachment, any drippage from your heavy machinery, or potentially you were also worried about your drivers getting backing up into that area and getting stuck or hurt or whatever. So I'm just curious as to, I mean, that a silt sock, a silt fence, that's pretty temporary. So I'm wondering if there could be a solution that we could find. It might be a little more like some sort of small berm or something that might
protect. I was wondering this
protect.
Thing, a small berm.
Right.
To keep them just from the creep from happening all
right.
over again.
But it looks so much better.
I think if you had trucks around, you probably would have to put some sort of, you know, safety barriers or what have you.
Right.
They just, so, you know, someone doesn't back where they're not supposed to.
Right.
I mean, even if you put, say, concrete or granite bounds, a truck isn't necessarily going to see those.
Uh-uh.
Even if they're sticking out
right
2 feet,
over
because
it.
They're kind of camouflaged. You're going to
right.
snap it off.
And the kind of machines they must use
yeah.
would
so
run right over them without even noticing.
So toothpick, yeah.
What do you think about it in the front? I mean, I'd rather not put it. You know, if we're going to do that, I'd like to go with the line that we agreed upon and just put one. I mean, the reason we're doing this is because I can't afford to keep coming here and asking for things and paying these guys. I just want this thing to be done. You know, so, you know, I was surprised at the amount of money we had to pay. At the beginning, we said there would be no fines if we worked together, and I got that fine, so there's not a big advantage, you know, to me, you know, doing all this. It's going to take me years to get this money back with this whole thing, so I just want to be done with this. So this is why I did this. I'm doing it tonight. This is it. Let's get out of here. You know, I can't go on. You know, it's crazy.
Yeah, I mean,
yeah.
You save a dollar a ton, and it's going to take me 3 years to get the money back.
I'm talking from an operational. I mean,
yeah.
You obviously, we don't want the trucks to go where they're not supposed to, and obviously you don't either. So, I mean, you could handle that operationally from your
yeah.
running your facility.
Yeah.
And the seed, the conservation mix in here, that could serve to be a visual barrier for the trucks. And also, Steve, would that help with the absorbing the runoff? Kind of we were talking about.
Yep.
So, I mean, that's quite a nice barrier that they've provided there. So that could function as something that would absorb any kind of oil-based runoff, as well as any material runoff in rainstorms, et cetera. What do you think? Is that reasonable?
I just worry about, given the quantities of material that are here, not having a real barrier. This is what you put up for a septic system or a single family house. I just don't know if that's adequate given the type of activity, and it needs to be maintained. I'd prefer to see something more permanent and more functional.
Could we put in the conditions that, can we condition it somehow?
I mean, conditions require oversight. And you want, again, permanent, not something that you have to worry about maintaining. I think everyone would be happier that way. It's permanent. They don't have to deal with it.
I mean, if we could, you know, if I could move that in maybe 10, you know, feet, I would like to do that. And just put one row of block, because I was going to sell this block and recover some money. Now I'm going to have to spend money to do this. And, you know, I'd like to, you know, if I'm going to do that, I mean, the yard's going to be tough to operate. And we got to size down the operation of what we're doing because of this. I mean, I'd like to go.
But why would it have to move 10 feet to put a block in? What if the block was in the exact same spot?
If
your 50-foot line
you
is a
like
50-foot
like
line,
this.
What does it matter what's 6 inches on the other side of it?
Yes, exactly.
Yeah, well, the blocks are like 3 feet or four feet wide.
Yeah, but just we're moving it 10 feet. Like, if you can put the blocks, you're not supposed to go past the silt fence, then you shouldn't be able to go past the block.
Yeah.
Like, it's not really changing that much.
So, Steve, is your point that if the block the back of the block was where the silt fence is, it'd be into the yard 3 more feet than the silt fence would be now. Is that what you're saying?
If I can move that in at any, you know, every foot means a lot to me. You know, it's, you know, this is really narrowing down what we're doing out there. It's, you know, it's going to make it, you know, I want to be work safe. And, you know, I would rather leave just the silt fence and just maintain it.
I mean, the way they've got it, this kind of brings it back to the 96 requirements. The problem is if we start putting blocks again, then we're moving, it changes the whole plan, kind of goes out the window again.
Yeah. The berm option. Just something that kind of, it's like a physical barrier to prevent erosion. I just, you know, it's graded so nice and smooth straight down. There's more vegetation to stop it, but the amount of material. There's also the block wall.
It was just a very gentle upslope before you get to
Correct. There's also the wall, so there's the wetland on the other side of the mound of dirt with a proposed block wall over there also. You know, that wetland doesn't have the buffers on it. It's not really being called out on this plan, at least. Just something that we did talk about before as part of the, technically, those are waivers blocked within that area.
Oh, on the other side?
Yeah, right, yeah, sure. Yeah. I mean, it's a tight site. So.
Yeah.
Up here? We haven't even looked at that.
No, no.
Yeah, that's what.
So I think part of, so I did get a, you know, per our usual standard third-party review estimate for the work. You know, one of the things was to kind of confirm that wetland line. The original review was just done of the wetlands that were filled and evaluating that. You know, it's one of those things the commission should be looking at the whole property holistically as far as anything within the CONCOM's jurisdiction. You know, one of the original plans showed, you know, a stormwater feature, which is pretty much a small depression in the natural, in the contours in the parking area as the stormwater. And I was always calling that out as there's no real intentional stormwater being done here, given the amount of material and their closeness to the proximity to the resources. And I think this needs to be looked at a little more, in a little more detail.
Yeah, I mean, I think trying to bring it back to the 96, what was approved then?
Just so I'm clear, on relative to verifying the wetlands line, Steve, you just talked about.
Mm-hmm.
When I left this hearing, or this meeting on the 19th of March, I thought we all agreed upon this was going to be the limit of restoration. Now, we have a plan that we signed it, and mm-hmm. we also agreed to it. So
mm-hmm.
I don't know what verification of wetlands we're doing at this point in time. We've already been out there with BSA digging holes, and we dug holes. And
the other side of the property.
Yes,
I think he's just talking about
the wetlands
at
the top. At the top.
The top, top corner there. Yeah.
We have never looked at that.
We've never
and
looked at that.
I feel like it's unreasonable for us to go there.
Okay.
This is our focus. This is what they've come here for all that time.
Well, it started with an enforcement.
That's what started
it.
It
did.
That's what
started
it.
Sorry, not they've come here for.
That's what initiated it. Typically, you look at all of the waivers on the property. The block wall technically is a waiver. I'm just letting you know what the estimate is. They recognize that line had not been confirmed yet.
When we came and met with you, you asked us to put that wall there. I mean, that's why
I agree.
That's why we put that.
There was a discussion.
The blocks. Excuse me, the blocks.
Take it out. Let's take that block wall out.
So then you have a pile of dirt, 40 feet from the wetlands. What protection are you? I mean, that dirt is within the 50-foot.
That needs to be there. That's fine.
Right.
Have you already put that in there?
Blocks?
No.
Okay.
Are those blocks also a part of this NOI, correct? The top
ones?
Yeah,
yes,
yeah, we were asked to put
correct.
It in, so we did.
Yeah.
Where this wetland line is here, or it's a foot or two this way or that way, I mean, I think it's really irrelevant. We know there's wetlands back there. It's pretty clear cut where it is. I just think we're just spending money to get consultants to look at a few wetland flags and say, move this flag 2 feet or 3 feet. I mean, I'm not trying to, be difficult, but I just think we're not trying to get to the real meat of the matter here and the real reason we're here tonight.
Well,
if we
proceeded
that.
As you suggest, we could not approve that wetland line up top. Because excuse me?
And we're not really asking you to approve that line.
Right, and
but
we would
make
we
that
can
as part
say
of the,
we would not.
Part of the.
Correct, so it's
right.
Part of that condition.
So, really back to more of the concern that this project is concerned with, is this siltation line. So, Mr. Caruso, when we're talking about a berm, and I'm not talking about a cliff, but what about a gentle upslope that would just mark the edge of that there.
We have enough room in here, and it's flat, very, very flat, you know, relatively flat. We could, if you want us to grade up behind the silt fence,
right,
grade up before we grade down,
right,
a foot or two or whatever, just to have a, have, you know, it'll steepen the slope between
slightly
that burn down here, but still we have plenty of play to go with because it's not a,
it's,
right,
it's a 10-to-1.
I don't,
it's
have
very
a
flat
with that, Steve.
And that would be on
and
the on the wetland
on
side,
the inside
wetland,
of the,
mm-hmm,
silt fence.
Mm-hmm.
Between the silt fence and the wetland,
the buffer zone side.
Right.
Excuse me.
Right, so it doesn't, you know, cut to your yard more. I, we could do that.
Okay.
That, yes,
that, I think that would be helpful in terms of, you know, preventing the different types of runoff that might come from the yard.
And then the no-cut bounds could be placed along that berm and maybe,
right,
a heavier,
mm-hmm,
planting line,
yeah,
along,
yeah,
that to prevent encroachment.
Too. It's a little more natural and does provide, again, a line of demarcation of work area and area that we're trying to protect.
Mm-hmm.
It kind of accomplishes relatively simple the separation.
Mm-hmm.
Like a guardrail, I think, like a physical, like earth moving a berm. I like it for the erosion protection and the protection of the resources, but as far as encroachment, you know.
I mean, I
no cut bounds are a marker.
I mean,
so when you check on it yearly, you can
if we're
tell.
Trying to keep vehicles out, I mean, you could use something as just like they do on a highway, like, you know, barrels or whatever you wanted to, just something that's very visible to a truck driver or backing up or moving around, saying like don't drive through there.
Yeah.
Otherwise eventually, you know, you'll see the tire marks in there.
Well, what about a guardrail? I mean, that wouldn't be any impact, really.
You mean like a regular guardrail?
Sure, up on the berm.
Or at the toe of it. You know, at the toe of it.
I mean, so would the commission want one block there? Just one block high? And
I'm just wondering if that would be more functional for all the above. You know, it's a physical barrier and it, you know, for
as
the
opposed to a berm?
I think originally.
I see.
Yeah,
I
was leaning towards. The
so
berm is just
because
they didn't want to put a block there. But if we're talking a berm, the berm's going to be more than 6-8 feet wide, start to finish. If a block could do the same thing in a smaller footprint.
I see. Inside that siltation,
correct,
line.
You know, starting at the front edge. So if they're 3 feet, it will go 3 feet and a 4 feet, whatever the blocks are.
I just think the berm would perhaps. Well, or are you talking about blocks touching, not
correct,
not
right,
gap?
I
see.
Mean,
so
the block's more,
gotcha,
commercial looking. The,
yep,
other one has some habitat value. You know. Some more plants, more filtration, things like that. So either way, it's just whichever one's going to stay and have the least amount of encroachment on it.
Yeah, the other thing you could do is like a crushed stone berm that was, you know, reasonably good-sized crushed stone. Yeah,
mechanically
would,
filter
it,
stuff.
It would be more durable, certainly, than try to put an earthen berm there, especially if you get trucks going by there all the time. You're probably going to get some of them hitting them, you know. So maybe the block wall or a crushed stone kind of, you know,
or
relative,
maybe a combination of all the above, like some,
yeah, wow,
some
belt
softer,
and braces,
some softer,
and
yeah.
So I can't believe I'm saying this, but I think I agree with Steve over here.
Wow.
Can we make a note of that time and date?
I know. Huh? If we took the blocks that Steve has and makes one row,
yeah,
one block high, like a touch together, continuous,
yeah,
all the way around here, with the face of the block being
on, yeah, the siltation line.
Siltation line, so the thickness is going to go into the 50-foot area. That's going to make a much more permanent.
Yeah,
it solves the problem. You don't need to have those markers and stuff because it's there. You can't go anywhere.
Great.
We'd want some markers on the other side, just,
okay,
so there's a, you know.
You can put markers. You can glue them on top of the,
yeah,
the face and the wall, markers and stuff, whatever. So
yeah,
I think that makes the most sense.
Okay,
As long as the blocks aren't, you know, 10 feet in, if they're kind of as they're drawn,
the face,
right,
the
on
face
there.
The block will be right there. So if the block is 3 feet thick, it'd be, you know, in 3 feet, or whatever.
Right. I think you're right that would be
you know, more permanent than an earth berm.
You know, yeah. Jersey barrier is thinner.
Okay.
I guess you could use those too, but whatever
looks
works.
Good.
Well, they're wider at the base, so
probably not more than 3 feet. I don't think, but
well, I think he wants to use what he already has.
Yeah.
And you're used to it, right?
Yeah. Reduce, reuse, recycle, Carl.
Sometimes.
We are the Conservation Commission, right?
Yes, that's right.
Let's see, any other comments? From
so then the top corner is not part of this.
Mm-mm.
Line.
I mean, it is.
It
Laura can say it's not, but technically, yes, it is.
It's
a resource. It's work in the buffer. Technically, it is. If a commissioner says they don't think it's relevant, but from an administrative standpoint, everything with 100 feet on this plan is part of this discussion. Different commission can say, I don't think that's relevant, this is, the wetland fill was kind of what brought us all here.
Okay.
But they're all waivers, they're all activity in the buffer.
Right, because those blocks aren't up there right now, so they're being put in.
It should say proposed
blocks.
Right now, it's just.
Steve had suggested, and I think it makes a lot of sense.
Yeah, I'm not saying don't do it. I'm just making it clear to the other commissioners that this is part of the.
Otherwise, it's unpermitted. It's kind of permitted without acknowledging it. You know, you want to, if, I'm not saying deny it, I'm just saying it should be part of this discussion.
I just wondered if there could be any siltation sock or something with that on the other side, just to collect anything that.
It's kind of a softer technique for protection versus the blocks.
No, the blocks are fine. The blocks are fine, but on top of.
Yeah.
Well, are you talking about up the top? Because it has a silt fence marked and a berm marked up here.
Correct.
Okay.
But those are new. That block wall is a new proposed activity in the CONCOM jurisdiction.
There's an existing silt fence behind where the blocks are going. There already is a silt fence.
Correct.
Okay, and they'll be kept
up. That will be maintained. Yeah. That's part that's part of the design. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, I'm not saying deny that activity. I just think the commission needs to acknowledge it as part of this project that we can oversee it and acknowledge that technically that's a waiver. It's a block wall. You know, they don't even have the buffers over here to show you how close it is. Mm-hmm. That's 25 feet away. That's great if the commission wants to approve it. Just acknowledge it and have the buffer mark, you know, 50, 75, 100 shown so you know what's going on over there and acknowledge it as part of the project.
Is this berm already here or do you need to work on that?
I'm sorry.
The blocks?
This berm up the top. The no, there it says here, berm.
That I don't think we have something.
Where are you looking?
Here.
An existing silt fence.
Existing silt fence.
Right.
Left, go left.
Oh, berm.
I think it's an existing.
That's existing? Okay, so you don't need to construct that.
No, it's been there forever.
Okay. Okay.
That's existing topo.
Okay, that's fine. That was my question.
Yep. I mean, I wouldn't mind seeing that block wall, the southern block, the short one that isn't really labeled as proposed. Just being a little bit larger, kind of wrapping, you know, go to the property line edge and wrap around a bit. Keep in mind that little stockpile marking, it's a big pile of dirt. And again, we've seen how these move. Containment, preventing it from encroaching in the future would
taking
be nice.
Taking it towards that trailer.
So take it towards a trailer and take it to the property line. They can't go any further than the property line. But, you know, if they have the blocks on site, just to put a few more, just to a little extra protection in, no cut bounds. Again, that's
how would that
you're
be?
You're talking about going north.
Here,
to the north.
And then to
just,
the trailer.
Just contain the pile. Right now it's a line picked because that's where the pile is right now. But this pile is going to move, as we've heard before. It's fluid. Keep that from being the next area of concern.
Now, would you want it along the edge where that silt fence is marked or farther away?
Well, I think it goes away. I mean,
like along the edge of the pile as
kind of
it's currently
in line
shown.
With what it is right now.
Okay.
You know, it just makes sense.
Yeah, I think it does.
Is that
agreeable for you?
Problem with extending it to the north to the property.
Okay. Alrighty.
Because they did that on the other side, just, you know, that
and in recycling and reusing, we can use some of the blocks that we're taking from the other walls.
Exactly. See?
I mean, because if you look at the other side, the fence or the future block wall really does contain, you know, the entire resource area and protects it. I think the other side should kind of mirror that, you know. Again, keep in mind the amount of material we're talking about.
Okay.
Here.
So that's a change that we would need to mention in a motion that wall here needs to be.
Yeah, you'd want to see a revised plan.
Yeah.
Okay. Alrighty.
We can give them the feedback. That's a minor. That's a fairly minor mod, and we can have this.
Because there's some actual
ready to go.
Some details you actually want.
So we would want that extended. And the other change was
the
blocks on the inside
silt.
Of the silt fence here.
Correct. I mean, the no-cut stone-bound markers put, whatever, every 20 feet along the blocks, or you want to still put the granite post kind of just behind it so that they're not on the front edge getting hit.
Yeah, I'd have them behind.
Just some, you know, markers just showing that along it.
Yep.
And I think the regs, it's every 30
although
feet.
Although Paul suggested that they put it on the blocks.
Yeah, $3 each.
We have little plaques.
Right.
You can glue them onto them.
Yeah, they glue, and they also have holes, so you can tack them. Depends on what material you're using to attach them to. You know, but just showing it on the plan, just so we have all the details.
And they need to be, 25 feet apart?
Every 30
30 feet.
30, unless you have, like, a tight corner. Then
it's
you
on a corner, every corner, every 30 feet. The regs have specifications for their placement, 2 feet in, 2 feet out, that type of stuff. Again, if it's behind the block wall and the blocks are 3 feet high,
Yeah, because you don't want the trucks.
You know, maybe it's not.
They would probably break.
Yeah.
You can waive it. You could maybe waive the requirement. I think it says concrete or granite. Maybe we do pressure treated posts so we can get them above, because the blocks are what, 3-4 feet high. If you put 2 feet up, you're not going to see them. So maybe the commission can waive the material.
I don't know. I think the bounds are kind of there in perpetuity. The blocks could be sometime moved in the future. Those bounds are supposed to be like the locking line in the sand.
But you want to be able to see them.
And but that's really what the blocks are for, though.
Yeah. But the marker is kind of showing what they are. And if they're in the front edge, they're going to get destroyed or pulled.
I'm only concerned about pressure treated. I mean, 20 years from now, it'll...
But I mean, you could do, then it would be a concrete post, but it has to be more than what the regs say. The regs require 2 feet out of the ground. You'll never see it.
Yeah, I know you won't see it.
So maybe it's just, maybe it's 3 or 4 feet up, just as long as it's over the concrete blocks, whatever that is.
You don't think fixing them right to the face of the block or the top of the block makes the most sense? The blocks and
that's
this
what
high
you
up.
Were saying.
I mean, if they get ripped off by a tractor tire, then they have to be replaced. I'm just trying to make it permanent. Again, in the front edge with all the heavy equipment going
by. You're not
going to
be moving those blocks around willy-nilly,
no,
are you?
No. They're pretty heavy.
I didn't think so.
But a tire, I'm just talking a tire nicking on the way by, right? This is now a new passageway where trucks are going by all the time. Again, you want to put them up front, that's fine. I'm just trying to think of ways of making it more obvious, sticking out a bit.
See, what about if we put them on the ends, you know, on the wet land side?
I mean, the talking was to put them on the markers, on the blocks on the front edge.
Yeah.
I'm thinking about putting them on the back edge, not
on
the blocks.
That's what he's talking about.
Yeah.
On the back edge,
because
it's on, then they'll never get hit.
The tires aren't going to hit them. It's a detail. Do you guys know what I'm saying?
So do you want a post behind them?
I'm just thinking of some way to make it visible on the back edge so it's not impacted by any equipment.
But you don't want a pressure treated post.
No, it could be I'm just saying granite. You just have to make it higher because the regs say 2 feet.
Deteriorate.
I mean that's really why we come up with granite as opposed to any kind of wood.
As long as it's above the block, I think that's the only thing I'm saying. Right. Okay. If it's 2 feet, you'll never see it because it's under a 4 foot block. It's behind a 4 foot block.
We need every 30. I mean,
that's just every 30 feet, right?
Every 30 feet is what the regs say, or on the corners. And it's in the regs. There's some.
It costs you $43.
It's a detail. I can work with them offline if the commission is so inclined.
Okay, that's fine. Can we just say that?
The plaques.
Let's say.
I mean, they're going to come up with something on the next plan.
So I just want to make sure we've got all the details, you know, that we can discuss here, ironed out, so that they come in with a plan that we can approve. And
right.
Well, actually, we'd like you to approve subject to, so we don't have to come back. We'd like to. You to approve that subject to us giving you the plan that's acceptable.
We could basically agree that if we come to a decision of what we want for the final plan, you wouldn't even need to come to the next meeting.
Right.
If you could just send the plan in and we'll
that's
approve
what
it.
That's what we'd like to do.
And I have no problem doing that.
Okay.
I'd also
With other hearings. We just did that with another one tonight.
Right.
So I think also more plantings, it just seems thin on the plantings, like double or triple of them, because technically there's an 80% survival rate. I think it would just be smart to put more in. This spacing is pretty far apart, given the size of the area. There's, the most of the plants there, you know, Lilibeth's not here, so I have to do the Lilibeth. they have, like, blueberries and smaller shrubs that are 20 feet apart plus. I don't even know what the scale is on this, 40. You know, 20 plus feet apart. Typically, those are every 5 feet on center. So, again, if they can, 5 feet on center, that whole area, and then seed mix it, I think it'd be more stabilizing.
I mean, as part of this, I just want to make it clear that I guess you still got some issues going on with the planning folks and all that. I mean, us approving this has really, that's still under your bailiwick.
That's a separate,
I agree. It's a separate issue. But if we approve this, doesn't mean that all that other stuff goes away. I just want to make that very clear.
It certainly does not, no. We've argued to have that separation, so we can't argue both ways.
So, I mean, we've had numerous people come in here complaining about the noise issues and all that, the noise pollution. That's really not a conservation per se. You can talk about noise being pollution, but not typically under the law.
It's not one of the interests under the Act or the bylaw.
I understand.
I agree.
So if we can get a plan, like get it rolling like next week, I can send out to the commission for just a quick review to make sure that it captures everything we talked about tonight, and I can give my feedback, and hopefully if there's any minor modifications before the next meeting, we can have that.
Steve, why don't we do this? Why don't I do a revised plan and email it to you?
Perfect.
And
I can
look at
forward.
It, talk back and forth, so and then once you say it's okay, get
our next meeting is August 20th.
As I tell everyone, communication is very important.
So I have four things here. extend the wall in the north out to the property line and down to the trailer following the edge of the pile.
Right.
Right? Increase the density of the plantings by about a factor of 2 or 3.
Or 5 feet on center.
Which we'll,
5 foot on center.
Which we'll talk to our wetland scientists about so that we can,
okay,
we can do that.
All right. And I also have installing the block wall within the silt fence line, mm-hmm, along as marked on that plan. And the do not disturb markers will be within that line, within the block line, but visible above the blocks.
Right. You were listening.
Is there anything else?
Yeah, it's what? Just one.
That's, I was,
that's a
listening.
Single, that's a single,
single
block.
Level block, yeah.
Thanks.
So if that's it, and that's our recommendation, actually, I will open up to abutter comments. I'm not seeing too many abutters out there, but I will be legal, and I will open up to abutters.
I got four or five emails from abutters that couldn't make it tonight.
Okay. Are there any abutters to One Industrial Way out there? If so, please identify yourself for the record, and you may speak. Seeing none, do we have any correspondence related to that, or no? Okay. And if that's all the comment from the commission at this point, we can continue this to the next hearing,
August 20th,
and when we get the plan with these things on it, we can proceed if there's no other comments, concerns.
Can I just ask one thing?
Sure.
If we're not planning on coming to the next hearing, can we get just a draft of the order of conditions that you're intending to present to the commissioners that night?
Yeah, I can.
Before then, so I have a look at it.
It's boilerplate. And
yeah,
I haven't heard heard any specific additional conditions that have been bounced around, but I can do that. It's pretty much our template for the conditions.
Chairman, I'll make a motion to continue One Industrial Way to the meeting for August 20th at 7:15. It is GCC 2015-09, DEP 161-0805, with the changes detailed earlier.
Okay, is there a second?
Second.
We have a motion that's been seconded to continue the notice of intent for One Industrial Way to August 20th at 7:15 p.m. Is there any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Not standing.
So I did have the one last issue, which maybe I can talk to Steve about, which is we still have that 1996 order of conditions. I know we had the penalty, but that's still hanging out there. I can't, there's no original out there.
We can close it out
sure
as
it's
part of the closeout of everything at
just
the end.
Soon do that at
we
the
have
end.
To close out the this coming order conditions, the old one, and close out all the enforcement actions. So my recommendation is all at the end is one broad. Once this is done, they'll apply for a COC for this project. You can do one for the old one.
But I haven't recorded it. That's
we'll deal with it. If you want to record it now, if you're comfortable doing it.
I'd have to come back to you to record it because I'd have to get a.
You can ask
copy.
For. You could request a.
I'd have to get
copy.
A tested copy from you because you're the issuing authority. So
at the end, put in a request for that, and we'll clean up everything at the end.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you, gentlemen.
We can just make sure the minutes reflect that, so we don't have to chase after that. If I'm not here,
well,
Paul's not here.
We have a video, so we have it all captured.
Well, if it's in minutes, at least we'll have that. So.
Thanks
for
coming.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, folks.
Thank you very much. We'll miss you.
Yeah.
I don't know if you'll miss us.
They're not going to miss us.
Never mind us. Come again. Come on. Generosity
there.
Thanks, losing guys. Family.
Yeah.
Thanks, guys.
Bye. Well, thank you.
Thank you. Okay.
Not the longest wait we've ever had.
And there was one.
It being on or after 7:40 p.m., I'm going to open up a new notice of intent for 17 to 19 West Main Street, GCC 2015-10. That's for a failed sanitary disposal system within 100 W. If I could have the applicant and a consultant, and if you could identify yourself for the record, please.
Sure. Good evening. Greg Hoffman from Williams and Sparagus.
here representing the restaurant group for the notice of intent filed for the Spot Restaurant. I have the green cards.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
There were a lot of them.
Oh, yeah.
It's tight down there.
And thanks for squeezing us on the agenda.
You got it.
You're entirely welcome.
So basically what's going on, everybody knows where the restaurant is, I'm assuming. It's downtown. It used to be the Old Town Tavern. Rory O'Connor's, Broncos. It's had a few different names. Not a lot of room back there. There is a wetland that stretches out and eventually connects behind the antique store. I think it's Settlers Antique.
Mm-hmm.
Buffer zone extends onto this parcel as well as a lot of the abutting parcels. What happened was the septic system went in 1998, plus or minus. And it was what's called a FAST system. It provides a level of pretreatment. My guess is it went in because of the cramped quarters available for the system. It allows a smaller footprint. FAST systems work great as long as they're maintained properly. Being a restaurant, it has a grease trap. The waste is a little different than a residential flow. Our guess, after talking to the Board of Health and looking through their records, is that it wasn't maintained properly. And what's happening now is there's breakout, and it needs to be replaced. They're pumping it regularly, you know, two or three times a week. There's been some complaints from the neighbors. Our clients inherited this problem.
You said there's breakout. Is it actually leaching into the wetlands?
No, but it is evident. The Board of Health is aware, and we've talked to the Board of Health, and they've considered it somewhat an imminent threat to public health, which is why we've kind of put this on the fast track. The applicant already has a contractor lined up, but in order to dot all our I's and cross all our T's, we're here. And what we're recommending and proposing is to essentially remove the pavement over the existing, let me back up a minute, this is West Main Street here, this is the rear of the restaurant. This yellow line is our erosion controls that we're proposing. The purple line is the lot. The gray amoebas, I'll call them on the plan, are the tanks. There's a pump chamber, a grease trap, a septic tank, and the FAST tank, all crammed into this little area. And then the effluent, once cleaned and treated, gets discharged out to the leaching facility, which is this large box. It's a pressure-distributed leach field. It has 1.5-inch PVC lines, and the effluent under pressure is discharged into that field.
Was
pavement.
Was the existing one that large, or where's the existing one?
The existing one is what I have colored here, and the proposed one is what I have colored here. It's the same exact footprint.
Okay.
The soils out here are great. It's a less than 2-minute-per-inch sand with a deep water table for the area. So we talked to the Board of Health, and we took a look at who did the testing, who reviewed the plan back before Deb was here, and it was a competent individual. Karen Springer was out here for the testing, and Elaine Wozni reviewed the plan. They're very good, very trustworthy, so everybody was comfortable using the same soil test pit data. So the need to go out here and do an additional test pit just didn't make sense. We'd be digging through the existing system to find sand. So all in, it's removing what's there, disposing of it properly in a facility that takes this type of waste off-site, and building a new bed in the same footprint as building it. If everything checks, they're going to backfill, pave, and they'll be out of there. It'll be essentially what it looks like now. There'll be no mound, no change in grade. The tanks are all staying. It's just the field itself. But because it's pavement, you know, we'd recommend some type of a mulch sock or something on the pavement just to provide a level of protection for the resource area. We're about 75 feet away, I'm sorry.
So there's pavement, where's the pavement now?
The whole lot is pavement, right up to the fence. The fence is not exactly on the lot lines in some spots.
Board of Health has approved that, pavement over the leaching field?
Yeah, it's actually allowed when you have to do it as long as the system's vented. Yeah, and that's right in Title V.
Has this been approved by the Board of Health?
The Board of Health has ordered this to be repaired.
Have they approved this design?
They have the design. They're on board with getting this done as soon as possible. So, yes. And because we thought we might be on the August agenda, we asked for we requested an emergency certification to allow this to go in sooner than later. We'd still like to do that and not wait for an order, if possible, but we fully understand it's up to the commission.
I mean, we had talked previously. I'm ready to order, issue in, like, an emergency certification on this. If needed, we could sneak them in. To be honest with you, the DEP hasn't gotten comments back yet. We cannot close this out tonight.
No, they no comments, and
oh,
we
they
have
did.
A file number. Yep.
Oh, awesome.
Yeah, it's 808 with no comments.
Yeah, my concern is if, you know, you're telling me you potentially have breakthrough right now. I mean,
uh-huh. We're still willing to do it. As soon as possible, we'll do whatever it takes. I just didn't know that the comments came in,
yeah.
So that's great.
But you can issue an emergency certificate
without us. Has the Board of Health required
us.
This be pumped on a weekly basis or anything?
The
or
restaurant owner was proactive and was doing it. He had Wind River out there almost every other day. The Board of Health became aware of it because Wind River has to submit their pump results to the Board of Health. And any system that's pumped, I think it's more than 3 times in 1 year, is an automatic failure anyways. So this would have had to be done. It's great that it's already a fast system, because that's what we'd be proposing, something with a level of pretreatment, just because of the footprint we have to work with.
How much downtime would you have doing construction?
That's a good question. I'm not sure the answer.
Yeah, because they'd be pumping the whole time, I would imagine.
And
right?
Yeah.
They're going to have an interim tank brought in to...
they're keeping the same tanks.
Just keep pumping the tanks.
Just keep pumping it out.
Oh, dear.
Once
yeah.
a week or whatever.
Yeah, as needed. Yeah.
Twice a day.
And to be honest, where all the plumbing is staying intact, and all they're doing is cutting in the pavement, removing and replacing, this should be done in a few days.
Well, then I thought the question is the system big enough for you know, if we're talking about the same tanks, is it big enough for the current use?
It is. It's sized appropriately for the use, taking into account what you're eligible for when you propose a fast. It is a smaller footprint, but it's still within the parameters of what the restaurant is equipped for.
Again, it's, you know, the septic is Board of Health in that sense, but obviously my concern is if the system isn't sized properly, and then, again, we don't resolve the breakthrough issue, and we're revisiting it in a couple of years, and then, you know, potential damage to the resource.
I think we often kind of rely on the Board of Health to assess all that stuff. They do a lot more review of the engineering behind it. We kind of take it as they'll do that right by it. We just try to keep it as far away as possible, and obviously this is as far as away you can get.
Yeah, and it
if
is.
They've approved that, I feel like it's.
It doesn't sound like it's officially been, but they're getting.
I
there's
see.
Probably no stamp like approved, but they've ordered it. They're pushing it. They're reviewing it. They have not officially approved it.
Yeah,
to my knowledge.
We spoke with the Board of Health. They've exchanged a couple emails that Steve and I have been copied on, basically just asking, where are you in the approval process? When is this going to get done? They're getting calls from some of the abutters, and the pressure's on to get this thing fixed. So,
and we're accommodating the Concom end. If we'll issue, if they can do this tomorrow, we would issue it.
Many times we'll want to see the Board of Health approve
Correct.
Before we approve it, because
Correct.
Again, we don't know
exactly
what they're going to do. But I think this is a little bit unique in the sense that we're dealing with a potential emergency here.
Right.
And that's exactly what we're calling it, an emergency, and as the Board of Health's calling it, imminent threat to public health. It doesn't take much for a fly.
That sounds pretty serious.
Let's go for a drink.
And Steve brought up a good point. He asked me the question, you know, why did you check the box that this is exempt from the stormwater standards? And it was a really good question, because technically it's not.
No, I don't think it is.
But when you talk to the Board of Health, every once in a while you come across a project that just, it doesn't meet the exemptions, but there's no way to comply. Infiltration would have to be 25 feet from a leaching facility. The lot's only 45 feet wide, so by the time you look for available areas for infiltration, there is none. And we're not increasing any impervious here. It just, I talked to Pam Merrill at DEP.
So she's saying don't check it?
She said either check that it's exempt or don't check it and just provide an explanation in the narrative.
And I prefer, you know, from my perspective, it should be checked and then provide the explanation. I mean,
they should really revise the form to add a box that says other. And you could write see attached narrative, and then it would be cleaner. But you know, we are not increasing impervious here, and there physically is no area available for any type of infiltration here.
while the work's being done, do you have something to contain any?
Yeah, so the yellow line I show here is proposed to be a filter sock, you know, the mulch sock that it would wrap around the work
around the whole property
and kind of provide a little curtain in the low point. And that stuff, once you get a good rainstorm, it gets heavy and it should stick to the pavement, do a pretty good job.
Also, you know, planning to do the work, if it's 1 or 2 days, maybe 3, just kind of looking at the forecast and not starting it during a rainstorm. It would be done, just be paved by, you know, there's almost no point to that. Just plan it not during the rain, and it's almost not necessary, but putting it down can't hurt.
Right.
You just don't want to do this in a little rainstorm. That's right. An easy fix to the erosion issue. It'll be paved within 2 days, and all erosion potential will be gone.
And we've worked with FAST on other sites. It is a good technology, but if you have a restaurant and you're not pumping that grease trap and you're not maintaining the tank, it doesn't take much to seal up that system.
And the commission has put in order conditions before that, you know, the applicant will pump. Actually, we've actually put pump requirements in order conditions that they will pump at X amount of
for
times.
For septics?
Yeah. Well, yeah.
Yeah, the last thing they want to do is have to do this again. Mm. So they're going to be very, very careful.
We've done this on like condo complexes where, you know, they put them in these central tanks and the condo association doesn't do the maintenance, same type of thing, and all of a sudden the systems fail. So we've actually put it in the order.
And the Board of Health's been great. They know what's going on out here. They're going to be looking for so the FAST requires a maintenance program, and they have to submit quarterly reports to the Board of Health. Those are reviewed. If the system's not functioning properly, FAST goes out, they tweak it, they talk to the restaurant owner, they try to find out what's wrong with it. So there's a lot of eyes on this now. And certainly our client's going to be making sure that it's
monitored.
But it's
supposedly had a FAST before, too, correct?
Yeah, but it's different owner now.
So it became a slow.
It definitely wasn't doing its job, and it sounds like the system sealed itself up.
So do we approve this and close it and say it? Okay,
yeah.
So you can do an emergency?
It does. Either way, you guys can approve it. The paperwork, you'll sign in 20 minutes, and it's done. They can pick it up Monday. It doesn't get any faster than that.
No pun intended.
What do you say? I was ignoring it.
It doesn't get any faster than that.
Yeah, I mean, an emergency cert, it doesn't matter either way. This is just cleaner.
Oh, okay.
Less paperwork for me.
Are there any abutters to 1719 West Main Street? Anyone hiding behind the plans over there? I can't see.
We got two calls from two abutters, and they just requested a packet of what we submitted, and we didn't hear anything back.
What's the date on the plan?
The date of our plan, it was stamped 7/2/2015, and the plan is July 1st, 2015.
Thank you.
Can I ask a question?
Yep.
There was one of the abutters came and talked to us, and they also have a septic on the other side of that fence, again, really, really close to the fence. When we replace that system, is it going to impact their system?
It shouldn't. It shouldn't at all. I mean, you can put systems right up against one another. Yeah, usually they end up being 20 feet apart, just because they have to be 10 feet from either lot line.
Is that possible?
Well, in this case, we have at least 10 feet from the back of our system to the lot line. So even if hers was 2 feet to that lot line, we'd still have about 12 feet of separation. This should be no impact. One of the abutters asked if we were repairing a fence. It's a stockade fence that's leaning over. I didn't have an answer for her. Maybe.
So can we get your name and address for the record?
I'll entertain a motion. Any more questions? Any questions? Comments?
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to make...
And you said the DEP did comment and provided no...
It was under review, but now it says no comments.
Okay.
And what was the number?
808.
Okay. Make a motion to approve the NOI for 17 to 19 West Main Street. GCC 2015-10, DEP 161-808.
I second.
We have a motion, and it's been seconded to approve the notice of intent for 17 to 19 West Main Street, GCC 2015-10. Is there any further discussion? Any comments we need to make here, Steve? No?
I mean, not accepting lime. That's the boilerplate that, stuff I always put in there.
Yeah, actually, that should be fine.
Without accepting the wetland line.
So re-motion, not accepting the wetland line.
Yes.
Any other comments? Are we specifying anything in regards to silt sock versus no?
I think if we can specify it, but I think they're on that.
Yeah.
And not during a rain event. We often don't specify that. You'd be crazy to start this in the rain.
But
so.
It's summertime and those thunderstorms crop up
well,
so
within
easily
reason.
In the evening.
Within
reason.
You don't
reason.
Do it
okay.
when you hear about a massive flood.
Okay.
Hmm.
Great.
I'll have the contractor keep a tarp on site, and if they have any temporary stockpiles and a storm comes in, they'll just throw the tarp over the bottom.
Because a lot of the stuff is going into a truck immediately. There's no room for stockpiling. The stuff's going in a truck. Off-site, they're bringing stuff in, it's going to get souped out of a truck or dumped directly in the hole. So I'm not worried about the erosion as much on this site. I'll keep an eye on it, though.
Okay, and I'll call a question. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? All abstain. I will entertain a motion to close the notice of intent for 17 to 19 West Main Street.
Mr. Chairman, I'll make a motion to close 17 to 19 with the NOI for 17 to 19 West Main Street, GCC 2015-10, DEP 161808.
I second.
There's a motion that's been seconded to close the notice of intent for 17 to 19 West Main Street. Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? All abstaining. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
It's been a while. There's a lot of new faces.
We're all new.
So, Carl, we jump back to 175 Central Street.
Well, I have one.
And
oh, you do? Oh,
Central
lovely.
We'll be in touch
thank
Monday,
you.
Tuesday.
Somehow I took it from
hogged
you.
Hogged them all.
I know.
Okay, it being on or after 7 o'clock, I'm going to reopen 175 Central Street, GCC 2014-25, and that's a septic system replacement. And we've been asked to continue that.
They actually didn't reach out to me. I just haven't heard from them. This one's been going on for a while.
Yeah.
Oh, yes. This was...
This is Dunkin' Donuts?
No, this
is the old garage.
Right on Brook Street.
The old garage.
Brook Street and Central Street. It's that kind of small engine repair spot.
Yep.
At the meeting that they did attend a while back, there was a bunch of questions and concerns, and they went away, and we're supposed to come back.
It was a culvert. We were talking about the culvert.
Yeah, there's a handful of issues. You had a really couple of good points. They've come in a few times saying they've resolved a couple of them and they still need a few more things, and I just asked them to clean up the plan and get it in as soon as possible. So I have not actually heard from them.
So we're
looking to continue it to September 17th at 7 o'clock just to bump it out a little bit because they're not going to be ready for the next meeting.
I will entertain a motion to continue to September 17th.
Go, Drew.
Mr. Chairman, I make a motion to continue the NOI on 175 Central Street, GCC 2014-55. DEP,
25.
25, sorry. Dyslexic. DEP number 161-0797.
I second.
We have a motion that's been seconded to continue the notice of intent for 175 Central Street to September 17th at 7 p.m. Is there any further discussion?
Yeah.
All in favor?
Aye.
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 Opposed? All abstain.
Sorry, who's the second thing?
Rachel.
And we have another one we need to continue.
Second dyslexic person here.
That's why she's only allowed to second.
Right.
It being on or after 7:15, I'm going to reopen a notice of intent for 269 Central Street, GCC 2014-04, and that's the miniature golf course and cafe. And I believe
they
in this
did,
case we've been asked to.
They did request a continuation to the August 20th. The wetland scientists are just trying to get the wetland line confirmed in the fields so then they can take a step back and look at the activities. So we're there's, I think, some miscommunication whether who was going to hang the flags and if they were hung, and it's details that you guys don't need to know. Just there's been a delay. So
he was hoping to have the golf course in, I think, by now, wasn't it?
The ice cream joint's there.
The ice cream joint.
Yeah.
So. They've got
that's
ice cream
that's already
there.
The ice cream joint's
ice
there.
Ice cream joint's
it
over
is?
There. Yeah, it's,
yeah.
On the, it's over the other side. They're proposing to move it.
Yeah.
There is an ice cream place there. So
the old one? No, a new
the
one.
The old little one?
Yeah, the,
yeah,
the old one to the right of the main facility.
For several years.
Right.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
Oh,
is it
that
selling ice cream again?
Oh, I've no. Idea. No, those folks moved out to Groveland.
I know.
Oh,
so where's the ice cream place there now?
Okay.
Everybody's hungry.
No, somebody mentioned ice cream.
Throw chocolate at her.
Is that how I met you guys on a sidewalk? There's ice cream.
So I guess the bottom line is we're looking for continuation. They're not ready yet. We're still working on some of the details.
All right. Yeah. We need to continue this to the 20th of August. I'll entertain a motion.
Continue.
Mr. Chairman, I make a motion that we continue 269 Central Street until August 20th.
Or second.
At 7:20.
At 7:20. We have a motion. And it's been seconded.
I wrote 30.
And is there any further discussion? And that's to continue at August 20th at 7:20 p.m. Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? All abstaining. Thank you.
Bills to pay.
And we have an EO to discuss too. We skipped off.
I'm sorry, you're right.
Summer. On Summer Street.
No new update on that one. I took it off my discussion from my comments just because there's nothing new.
I drove by today to see it.
Yeah.
Nothing's happened.
Correct. They're supposed to be submitting a restoration plan to be approved by the commission.
Oh, okay. When?
It was supposed
to be.
Did
we give a date?
Yeah, it's supposed to be today.
Oh. Cha-ching.
I called them and I'm working with them. Again, I don't pay attention. I try to get it in as soon as possible. That's your issue to decide what you do with when it gets in and if it's late and if there's fines accruing. I've talked to the owner a few times and he said he'd have it in. I'll continue to reach out to him and get it as soon as I can. So it kind of is what it is.
Have you been, at some point you might want to point out what fines he's been accruing.
I will. So again, it's not much of an update at this point. It is what it is, which is why I took it off mine, unless there's something new or changing. Bills, Parker River Clean Water Association for some of the turtle work, a little over $1,000. Again, this is the Blanding's turtle work we talked about before. What else do I got? WB Mason, $375 for office supplies, electric, Bill Camp Dennison, $146.09. Georgetown Building Supply, total of $179 for miscellaneous hardware and stuff like that. Amesbury Industries, $25, also Camp Dennison. That's it on the bills.
Actually, I was late this evening because I was helping to release 6 Blanding's turtle hatchlings in the West Street wetlands. They are hatchlings who were hatched at the West Street fields. They were the size of a quarter last August. They were 8 grams, between 8 and 10 grams, and we just released them. They're about 130 grams. So we put them back in the wetland, and they went off happy.
So we'll forgive you for being late.
You didn't take any pictures, did you?
It was impossible to get a picture of them. They went so quickly. They were very happy to be out there. And
not even thank you.
They've all been marked with a number. So should they return to breed one day, we'll know who they are.
So that mark stays with them the whole
mm-hmm.
kind of like a scar.
You actually cut. They have a system around their shell. They have all of the scutes numbered, and they clip them in a different pattern that tells you what year they were hatched and
cool.
which number that year
it's like
they were.
Morse code for critters.
Yeah.
Body art for critters.
Yeah.
That's
cool.
Right.
How good big job. Would they have been size-wise?
They were the size of a quarter when we got them, and they were about this big.
In 1 year?
Oh, no, not a year.
Oh.
We started head starting them at the early October, end of September.
Wow.
So they say that if you don't do anything, out of 1,000 eggs, only 8 of them will grow to maturity. But by protecting the nests and head starting them, you can get, they're predicting 350 will survive to breeding age. So we might be overrun with them soon.
that'd be a good problem to have.
Yeah, wouldn't it?
So I just need a motion on the bills.
Yeah, let's get a motion to pay the bills.
I would like to make a motion to pay the bills as read by Steve.
Second. We have a motion. It's been seconded to pay the bills as read by Steve. Is there any further discussion? Favor?
Aye.
Opposed? All abstaining. Thank you.
I'm also going to send around, this is the order of conditions for the septic system we just talked about at the spot. Two pages.
We also submitted set up there.
Yep. This is the Pond Street, order of conditions for the Pond Street fence removal you guys approved tonight. This is 77 Lakeshore Drive, COC. This is a reissuance. We gave it to them a few months ago and they lost it, so we're just reissuing this. So it's kind of more of an administrative. Only one spot to sign.
I have a blue pen. I'm doing it.
I know, but.
No, you can do black. We just need one, at least one per group, just so we can identify the new documents. And there is a minutes floating around, 6:18. If that's been read and reviewed and everyone is comfortable with it, we can vote that on.
I didn't see them.
I read them.
Came as, through as an email. The email itself was the minutes.
Oh.
It wasn't an attachment.
So we'll take it that Laura hasn't read them.
I didn't get it.
Oh, really? I think we're having issues with your email.
Yeah, you don't have your government one open.
It won't let me.
It won't let me either.
We have to address that with the IT.
Laura's is the one that bounces back, though, but yours doesn't bounce back.
I can't even get into mine.
Yeah, Carl's same. We'll send something out next week to readdress that.
Yeah, we don't have access to
that. I have tried to set it up, but like Rachel, it tells me no.
Yeah.
Huh. I'm sending them to your home, your old email addresses as well as your government ones, so hopefully you should be able to read them in
Brooklyn. Yeah,
I'm getting it at mine, but I can't get into the other.
We'll contact the IT and maybe they'll work directly. We'll get on it.
So you want to wait on the minutes?
I think we might want to just let Laura, I mean, we're not behind. We're actually in pretty good shape. So let's let Laura read through them. We can always vote on the next meeting.
But we do need to resolve the email thing.
Yes, yes. I got their email.
We should have the technology to have emails, I guess, if we have them.
I agree.
People are sending us emails and we can't read them. This is not appropriate.
No, you don't have to. That's just administrative.
Can I ask, is it possible to ask a question? Have I used my quota? Am I allowed to ask about the Heather Road EO, or is that not discussable right now? Just remind me, did we add anything in there about actually removing the steps? I don't remember that being part.
We didn't change anything tonight.
Is that part of the restoration plan?
It was part of the original.
Yes, it was.
Put it back the way it was.
Okay. Good. Lovely.
And unless anyone has additional business to discuss, I think we're.
Oh, yeah. We'll entertain a motion to close if there are no more discussion items.
I make a motion to close.
Second.
The motion has been seconded to close the meeting for the night. Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
All opposed? All abstaining. Good night, everyone.
Good night.
Good night.